All right, we're going to call to order the regular meeting, the City Council, for Tuesday, January 17th. Roll call.
Councilmember Kusumoto?
Here.
Councilmember Murphy?
Here.
Councilmember Wilson?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Edgar?
Here.
Mayor Hasselbrink?
Here. And we're going to go into closed session. Lisa?
Yes. Good evening, Mayor and Council members. Tonight, we're going into closed session for conference with labor negotiator under with unrepresented employee under 54957.6. Conference with labor negotiator, again, unrepresented employee. And these are the city clerk and city manager, also under 54957.6. Conference with legal counsel, anticipated litigation first under 54956.9D3, that based on existing facts and circumstances, the City Council is meeting to decide whether a closed session is authorized. And then if you do determine that it's authorized, then under Government Code Section 54956.9D2, where a point has been reached in the opinion of the City Council on advice of legal counsel that based on existing facts and circumstances, there's significant exposure to litigation against the local agency. That should be changed from two potential cases to one potential case. And then lastly, closed session for pending litigation under 54956.9 D1 and D4, which is the People v. Dennis Lauren Bader case and the related red light cases.
Okay, we'll reconvene the City Council meeting. City Attorney, if you could report out.
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor. Council did meet in closed session with labor negotiator me and on both of those items, and is not finished, but we'll continue at another meeting, whether the next regular meeting or perhaps a special meeting. And with regard to the litigation matters, those closed sessions will continue at the close of this meeting.
If you could join me and stand for the Pledge of Allegiance and then remain standing for the invocation by Mayor Pro Tem Edgar. Ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please bow your head. Dear Lord, we just thank you tonight for giving us the opportunity to serve the community. Lord, we just pray for your wisdom and your blessings on the decisions that we have to make tonight. Lord, please take care of our first responders, our fire department, mm-hmm. our police, keep them safe. And again, thank you, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
If you could join me down for a quick presentation.
Go.
Can you hear me? There we go. We have a holiday decorating contest every year, and this year each of the neighborhoods decorated their homes, and we had 12 judges who came out to the different neighborhoods and awarded first and second place. And so tonight we have some of those awards here, and on the slideshow we have some of the houses that were decorated. Let's see. The residents from 3522 Thor for Old Dutch Haven, are you here? Okay. College Park North, 3782 Finley Drive. There we go. Yay! Thank you. Congratulations. Thank you. You get to come on up. Come on up. And then we have Greenbrook 3996 Myra. They here? And Royal Oak, our next door neighbors, 1081 Oak Street, space 70. There he is. Okay, oral communication. At this time, any individual in the audience may come forward to speak on any item within the subject matter jurisdiction of the City Council. Remarks, sir?
Shelley.
Oh, did I? Oh, I'm so sorry. Okay, we're back to presentations. Presentation by Becky Esparza for Orange County Human Relations.
She needs her mic back. We need the podium back. Trying to leave me early.
Yes. So this one back. Good evening, Mayor, Council Member. Becky Esparza is sick tonight, so my name is Don Hahn. I'm the senior staff of Human Relations. So I'm here to present our annual report from the council to the city. We at Hosting Human Relations believe that people have the right to live in this county that is free of discrimination and prejudice, and living in respectful neighborhood and community. As the service we provide for Los Alamitos, 2016, we provided 14 cases in mediations, and three of those cases are involved with family divorce mediation. We have some of your youth that came to our youth conference back in November at Cal State Fullerton here. It's a diversity conference for youth, high school youth. In conclusion, we are so happy to be able to partnership with you for the last 25 years, providing some of these services to your community. And thank you so much for having us tonight. And also tonight, we also have a commissioner, Elliot Singer, who's also represent your board at our commission at the county seat.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Next, we have the Orange County Fire Authority presentation on our emergency service delivery enhancements.
Good evening, Mayor and Council Members. I'm Battalion Chief Steve Edwards. I'm here filling in for Chief Cruz to do a presentation about our service enhancements for the upcoming emergency service delivery here in the city of Los Alamitos and adjacent cities. So if I can direct your attention here. Approximately 2 years ago, Fire Chief Bowman directed our staff to look at the delivery of emergency services throughout the areas we service in Orange County. Five goals were identified for this study. Number one was to improve the level of service and increase firefighter safety. We wanted to decrease the response times for advanced life support arriving on scene. We wanted to decrease the number of responding units. We wanted to increase our depth for second call coverage when two calls in the same area arrive simultaneously. And then also to decrease response requirements on automatic aid resources. This is when we have agreements with surrounding areas that they share resources with us and we share resources with them. We want to minimize that wherever possible. For the staffing here in Los Alamitos, Orange County Engine 2 over there on Green Street is staffed with three firefighters, one of whom is trained as a paramedic. This is the normal staffing we've been utilizing for years. To deliver ALS response, the standard of care throughout Orange County is two trained paramedics. So the one paramedic on Engine 2 can initiate care, but to fully realize the standard of care, a second unit needs to arrive so that we have two ALS paramedics on scene. So we're here in Los Alamitos. We're served by two paramedic vans that are in adjoining cities, one in Cypress, one in Seal Beach in Leisure World area. And these paramedic vans are staffed with two trained paramedics, as well as them being firefighters. Current performance measures throughout the county are 80% of the time, our goal is to have a unit arrive on scene in 7 minutes, 20 seconds. We're currently achieving that. We're always working to lower it whenever possible. The times displayed to the right of it, call processing, that means receiving the call to our dispatch center, gathering information, verifying the location, takes approximately 1 minute. The call is transmitted out to the closest fire station. They have a minute and 20 seconds to be responding out of the station to the call. And then our stations are spaced out to where average drive time is approximately 5 minutes. So the areas affected in this phase three enhancement include the cities of Cypress, Los Alamitos, and Seal Beach. Of interest to Los Alamitos and the citizens here, primarily are Station 2 in Los Alamitos, and then the adjoining stations at Station 17 in Cypress and Station 48 in Seal Beach, because currently responses into the city of Los Alamitos require coordination between those three stations. There will also be a station in downtown Seal Beach affected, and a station on the Buena Park-Cypress border that will be affected by this phase three enhancement. Currently, these units are staffed as described on this chart here. All of the engines at Station 2, 48, 44, and 17 are staffed with three firefighters. Two of the stations also have a paramedic van located there with two firefighters on, and those are 48s and 17s. This totals up to 16 firefighters. Some of the response from the past 12 months for Medic 17, which serves this area, 816 of their calls are in Station 2's area in Los Alamitos. Medic 48, 320 of their total call volume in a year were in Station 2 or Los Alamitos area. What we're proposing to do here coming up is that Medic 17, the firefighters that are currently staffing it, will be reassigned to Engine 17 and Engine 2, making both of those engines four-person engines, but more importantly, providing two paramedics on each of those engines. Going through the staffing again, once we do our revised staffing, all the engines mentioned previously, 44s, 48s, 2s, and 17s, will all be four firefighter staffing, and each of those engines will have two paramedics, two trained paramedics on the engine. Again, this is just a total of 16 firefighters, so this is essentially just a redeployment of current staffing levels. We'll make the previously mentioned stations in each of the areas affected. All of those will now be complete paramedic units and will be able to respond to any medical emergency calls with two paramedics on them. So that decreases the ALS response time and reduces the number of units responding to calls for medical aids. We are going to evaluate these changes. They'll be a report provided at the 6 month mark and again at the 12 month mark. We've done this previously with there have been phase one and phase two enhancements, in other areas of the county, and I'm pleased to announce that in those other areas, we've seen significant reductions in the number of units responding to calls and also in the ALS response times, having two paramedics on scene at the call providing treatment. And additionally, we expect it to provide us additional safety and effectiveness for fire calls. Having four firefighters per unit increases the ability for us to be effective at fires with the initial arriving unit. It also provides for what we refer to as two in and two out. If there is the necessary need for firefighters to go inside immediately and rescue someone, we do so under the rule called two in, two out. Two individuals can go inside to effect the rescue. While providing for their safety, two individuals are outside the fire monitoring conditions and have the ability to go in and rescue our firefighters should they need it. Also, we expect it to reduce responses from surrounding agencies that we share automatic aid agreements with. We're targeting these changes. Everything is being put into place that March of 2017, we'll see the change in staffing. It's actually, I believe, scheduled for the first week of March. And again, we plan on evaluating this change 6 months from then, and then again at the 12-month mark. Again, following up with those goals I stated initially that we're using for these changes, we want to improve the level of service, emergency service in the area, and firefighter safety. We want to decrease our ALS response times, decrease the number of units responding to calls within the area, and increase our depth for second call coverage, and decrease the response requirements on automatic aid resources. We expect to, based on our previous phase enhancements, we expect to see the same improvements in this area in the city of Los Alamitos. That concludes my presentation. I'm happy to answer any questions from the council at this time.
Any questions, Ron?
Yeah, thank you, Chief. So on the 7 minutes and 20 seconds for that first call dispatch to providing aid, correct?
Yes.
And then in your experience, or in the I guess the when you've deployed the four person crew or engine, the second call was the one that, if I recall, was the one that was really iffy. If you didn't have enough, if you deployed two or three vehicles to a given emergency, you've really kind of concentrated all the resources in one area. Right.
Well, just with general logic, if we were looking at Station 2's area, if a call within Station 2's area occurs right now today, Engine 2 responds to it, and then either Medic Van 17 or Medic Van 48 responds to handle that call. Mm-hmm. Within the next 30 seconds, if another call comes down in Station 2's area, then obviously, since they're busy, we're drawing from a wider area, and that means a longer response time. It would be additional units from 17.
And then 17, let's say 17 doesn't have their medic van, then you have to draw a medic van from somewhere else, correct?
Exactly. So, and so the resources start getting drawn from further and further away.
But my question is, on the response time for that second call, do you have any metrics on that in terms of, is it still that 7 minutes and 20 seconds for that second call in this four?
When we use the 7 minutes 20 seconds, that is that is derived from our overall responses averaged out. So that includes the second calls.
Okay.
But I don't have the information for the second call specifically, what the average response time is for that. We have many calls that come in well under the 7 minutes 20 seconds, and that balances out the wider ones. We always look at it as that large general number.
Right, and I remember going to the simulation that was run over at OCFA headquarters, where they showed how the three-person engine versus a four-person and the just improvement in response time. So I get that, and it's really the second call, because if you have all the resources concentrated in one area, then you have no other resources to deploy. So that was my question.
And exactly, with this new staffing level, when those two calls go down, you know, relatively simultaneously in two's area, two will handle the first one, have an excellent response time to that, but the next arriving unit that will handle the second call is coming from closer in, and it's only one unit rather than requiring two more from various stations to respond. So that's where we hope to see dramatic improvement.
Understood. Thank you.
Anybody else?
Yeah, I've got a couple questions. So a firefighter and a paramedic, same skill set?
For our staffing in Orange County Fire Authority, we all are hired on as firefighters first. We then identify individuals, or they are hired by us with a paramedic license. So it's actually a dual function role. And not all of our employees have it, but a fair number of them do have it. When we staff a unit, we identify which positions are just a standard firefighter position, and which positions also require somebody that is trained as a firefighter and paramedic. Based on the types of calls we handle, typically you're doing one or the other. If we respond to a medical aid, it's the medical skills we require, and the paramedics do the bulk of the work. When we're responding to fires, it's firefighting, and that's the bulk of the work. On occasion, they end up overlapping, and we need to use one skill and then quickly shift to the other skill. But it's same individual. Some of them have additional training to be qualified as paramedics.
So is a paramedic a more expensive skill set versus a firefighter?
The paramedics receive a bonus or an additional pay category for their paramedic skills. That specifically in itself, since they're already paid as an employee, is marginally just a few dollars more per hour.
So in the new model where you shift from this hybrid with a lot of different unit types to one paramedic unit type, and does that mean that all four firefighters have to be qualified to be a paramedic?
No. The staffing levels and the positions, and where I said some of the positions would be identified as requiring a paramedic license, within the units that I described there, it's no additional requirements on staffing. It's just relocating. The two firefighter paramedics that are currently on a paramedic van, that van will be decommissioned, and their work locations will be changed from the van to engine 2 and engine 17. It adds personnel to those respective engines, and also provides provides that two paramedic standard of care that we recognize here in Orange County. But it's essentially just relocating existing personnel in those four stations that were talked about.
Okay, and then just, I guess, and finally, your objectives that you're trying to accomplish on the back page, the delivery enhancement, the goals, really focus. It's hard to argue with safety, but if we could just talk about cost and the union contract, because I know when I was on, they were trying for four people per engine at that point. Is this a part of a negotiation that you guys did with the unions?
This was a directive that came from Fire Chief Bowman. It was identified early on as one of his prime directives.
But he's not there anymore, right?
Pardon?
Yeah.
Is Bowman there
Chief
now?
Chief Bowman is still our current fire chief. He replaced Fire Chief Richter.
Okay. So when through the negotiation that you guys were doing, is this part of the settlement of that negotiation for the union contract?
It's unrelated to the union contract.
Okay. So what cost-wise, what does that mean to the taxpayers? Is this a more expensive delivery, but better safety measurements, or how would you characterize it?
In the specific units that we addressed here, there's no cost. It's literally rearranging our staffing from using a couple of paramedic vans to having all the personnel staffed on fire engines. The engines are already existing. The personnel are already existing. This particular phase enhancement, there have been countywide within other areas, there were a couple of positions that were additional that were added to the department's overall staffing in different areas. And those were generally, we tried to arrange for grant funding to assist with the funding of those positions as they came on board.
If I may, though, Chief, it was cost neutral because you're redeploying existing resources. But I think the real the difficult part is the cities that lost the paramedic that was deployed somewhere else were the ones that would be of concern. So the net for us, it's plus, right? We end up picking up one more paramedic, and exactly. And then one of our neighbors lost one, and it's that was the hard decision that had to be made. So. Right. And then I think what you're talking about, the additional firefighters or paramedics, that was down in Dana Point. Is that the ones that you're thinking about? Because they had some vacancies that had, you know, that had existed for a long time, and finally I think the authority was able to get them funding in place to go out and fulfill those vacancies.
Exactly.
And then that kind of moved right into the four firefighter engine at that point down in South.
Exactly. Canada. And I think you can look a lot of this of this philosophy and changing of staffing is an evolution of paramedic service and program. Years ago when it was developed right here in Southern California, the initial thought was they were put on their own vehicle, two paramedics, and that's the way they responded. We've learned, you know, many, many things over the years, and also with, you know, like many government agencies, learning to be ever more and more cost conscious. This is kind of an evolution that gets us in that way. Also, what drove a lot of this is, you know, we do our customer surveys, and I won't tell you how many thousands of questions we get. And the first question is, why do so many units respond to my call when they see two red vehicles and an ambulance for, you know, what they feel might be a minor call? We show up to calls with preparation of the worst, because what's reported to us on the phone and what we actually find is not always the same. And we want to make sure we have enough personnel and equipment to handle whatever we're faced with. But we also took heart to those questions from the from citizens saying, you know, why so many? And we looked at it and said, is there a way we can address this? And a lot of this this evolution was driven by that one question.
Right. Well, I appreciate you coming up and giving us an update. Thank you.
Thank you. I know as part of Fire Authority, we've watched phase one and two be implemented, and we've given the recap. And I believe in phase one, advanced life support was able to start 32 seconds earlier based on this small change. So this is exciting. Los Al's able to take care of their own. I believe it also saved 5,000 vehicle trips per year. It was quite substantial in just the maintenance of the trucks and the vehicles, and also just being able to offer the services at a faster response time. So thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. My pleasure.
Next we have Andrea West from Orange County Transportation Authority.
Good evening, Mayor, City Council. As we get our PowerPoint pulled up, my name is Andrea West with OCTA Government Relations, and it's my pleasure to be here this evening with our team to provide you with an overview of the 605 Catella project, and also a brief update on the replacement planting project for the West County connectors that completed that project just a few years ago. If there's any questions you have related to other OCTA projects or programs, we'll do our best to answer those this evening, or we're happy to come back to a future meeting with more in-depth presentation on that item. I have Jeannie Lee with us this evening, who's a project manager, so she'll walk us through this PowerPoint, and we have some other members of our technical team here to answer your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrea. Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem Edgar and members of council. My name is Jeannie Lee. I'm a project manager from Highway Department from OCTA. I'm here to present 605 Catella Avenue Interchange Improvement Project. OCTA came to present this project a couple times in the past to Traffic Commission back in September 2014 and a council meeting last year, February. So they're a key project partnering agency involved in this project, and I would like to acknowledge Caltrans as the lead agency and facility owner, OCTA as a project sponsor and implementing agency, and City of Los Alamitos in Long Beach as a project partners, but project limit is primarily in Los Alamitos. All the partnering agencies have been involved since the day one of the project study report, project development support, which is a previous phase of the current phase, which started back in July of 2013. So PSR identified the interchange currently experienced congestion during peak period, and the existing geometric elements do not provide needed optimal traffic operations. The interchange has a high concentration of congested related accidents, and interchange currently has discontinuous facilities for both pedestrians and bicycle traffic. The purpose of this Measure M project is to improve freeway access and arterial connections, improve interchange traffic operations, enhance safety, and improve pedestrian and bicycle facilities within the project limit while minimizing adjacent right-of-way and environmental impacts. The improvements would serve communities of Los Alamitos, Cypress, and Rossmore. The project will modify interchange ramps and lane configuration on Catella Avenue from Coyote Creek Channel to Civic Center Drive. So this is the project area, highlighted in yellow. And I would like to highlight some major improvements that's included in this project. So the project will improve lane continuity on Catella Avenue through the interchange. For example, lane continuity on eastbound Catella with the three throughput lanes will improve the capacity of eastbound Catella as it goes through the interchange, and numerous other lane continuity that we're providing. And also, we're providing signalized northbound ramp intersection. This is where it was identified as above statewide average congestion-related accident per hotspot analysis that was done previously. And signalizing this intersection will provide safety for all modes of transportation, not only vehicular, but pedestrian and bicycle traffic as well. And add a second lane to northbound exit ramp to accommodate high exit volume. Keep in mind that the second lane is added only at the freeway segment, where it helps drivers to make a decision which ramp, off-ramp lane that they need to take off. And this does not add capacity to the off-ramp itself. Also, another major improvement that I would like to highlight is improved pedestrian and bicycle facilities on Catella Avenue through the interchange. Signalized intersection crossings, providing standard travel lanes and shoulders width, and then lane continuity, they're all for the safety features. We're currently in the process of developing highly detailed traffic simulation, which will use as a tool to confirm the purpose and need that I just mentioned to you, and associated interchange improvements. The city is involved continuing the development of the project, and we're working closely with the city staff to coordinate the future development along the Catella Avenue in our project area. So next slide presents a schedule and funding for this project. The funding source is M2 for the environmental phase only. The City of Los Alamitos has been involved, as I mentioned, in the previous phase from the beginning to the end, which was from July 2013 to May 2015. The environmental phase of the project was initiated in late August of last year, and is anticipated to take about 24 months. We're anticipating the environmental document to be circulated for public comments around spring of 2018, next year. The project is designated to be environmentally clear in the OCTA Next 10 delivery plan that was recently adopted by our board members on November 14, 2016. Now, I would like to have OCTA Public Relations Officer Chris Buckley to come up and share the latest public outreach information.
Good evening, Mayor, Mayor Pro Tem, Council members. As Jeannie mentioned, my name is Chris Buckley, and my colleague Jessica Lopez and I are in charge of public outreach on this project. We'll be joined by Westbound Communications on the project, and our objective is basically to generate public awareness, identify key community issues, really get a sense of what the public concerns are, and encourage public engagement and public comment in the process. This is the time for them to really get involved in the project. One of our first steps is to meet with key stakeholders. There are a wide range of them, as you know, going from next door here, the Lincoln Property Company, you know, the Village 605 folks. We want to engage folks from Los Alamitos Racecourse. We want to talk to everybody, you know, from the Lutheran Church across the street, all the way to Cottonwood Church, the Medical Center. We've got all of the schools close by. So we'll talk to those folks. We'll get a sense of what their concerns are, and we'll try to catalog those concerns so that we can have them going forward and get a basically be a voice at the, you know, at the table for residents, for business owners, for all community members. Some of the strategies that we'll use, we'll develop an easily identifiable project brand, right? So people know what the once they see it, they'll know that they can get information about the project there. We will take a bilingual approach to that. We'll also have a project fact sheet, a web page, a phone number. We've done this with other projects, and it seems to work really well. We will have direct mailers. We'll do community surveys. We'll have an email blast on a regular basis. During the environmental phase, the email blasts are typically fewer than, say, a phase like pre-construction or construction. The idea behind all this is that we develop a database of these key stakeholders. We develop a database of issues, and we can cross-reference those. We can look at them geographically. We can look at them in terms of issue. We can look at them in terms of level of concern. And as I mentioned, bring those issues to the table during this environmental phase so that the city and Rossmore and Cypress, everybody has a sense of a voice in the process and a seat at the table to the best that we can.
So with that, if you guys have any question on the 605 Catella project, any questions?
I do. So if you can go back to page 2, trying to understand what the project is all about. So, and it's very hard to read. Maybe a tip is don't use white letters and yellow background.
Sorry.
Yeah, but when you look at, so you said you're going to put a metered on-ramp light on that on-ramp right there. Is that what you're talking about?
Right.
So there'll be a stoplight here that allows one, two, or three cars in at a time? And the reason is that because you said it's a higher accident rate, higher than whatever?
Statewide average congestion related accident.
Because of
cars
that are entering the freeway too fast, is that why?
Currently, there are cars that's entering from east, traveling from the eastbound direction facing west, and trying to get on the on ramp, as well as there's a HOV lane on the there, and so there's a lot of. Based on the data that we looked at, it's more congestion related, meaning either side swipes or if there's a low speed that it might have rear-ended type of accidents. That's okay. What is shown currently. And so this will help. And also by doing so, when we were out there, when we did a job walk, it wasn't really, I mean, actually one of our team member almost got hit by a car trying to get on the on-ramp. So by signalizing, it provides definitely the concerns that we have as far as this bicycle and pedestrian safety.
But then the signalizing of it it'll be so many cars that have to be stored, right, in a queue somewhere. Right.
And that's something that we're going through.
And then that will back up onto Catella on those cars going typically westbound, right?
Right.
And so as it is, without a queue, without a signal light, the queue is really terrible as it is right now. So you're going to add something. It's a natural stop or a unnatural stop that will make people, it'll further back up Catella. So that's a concern. Mm-hmm. Now, the other one that you mentioned about the eastbound traffic, so I take it's on the south side here, you're going to do something to improve the merging of the four lanes here. But you don't talk about westbound, where we have that really strange merge from left to right, mm-hmm. which we've tried to address several times with Caltrans and got nowhere. So right. Why are you improving something that, in my mind, doesn't need to be improved, and really not allowing us to improve the thing that needs to be improved? It seems kind of backwards. And that's not a question, it's just a statement.
Sure.
Now, the other one is on the off-ramp of the northbound 605 off-ramp. Mm-hmm. You said you're not going to increase the capacity of how many cars that can be held in that off-ramp by going to the two lanes?
So two lanes, let me see if I could.
Right here. So you're gonna go to two lanes, which in my experience of driving, and I drive that 5 days a week,
sure.
I don't see any backup at all. And you're gonna go two lanes and not improve capacity. Why are you going two lanes?
Sure. So as far as the northbound off-ramp, the second lane is being added in function of the high exit volume, which based on our studies that's done in the past PSR as well as the hotspot analysis that was done for the 91, 605, 405 hotspot analysis that was done. Based on those data, they show that the AM peak hour volume exceeds the threshold. Because this interchange is within Caltrans right away.
Okay.
So we have to follow Caltrans.
So it's the AM traffic.
Right, AM
okay.
peak. Right.
And I don't drive that direction in the morning. And that's fine. I understand that.
And then regarding your comment earlier about the eastbound that I mentioned about the lane continuity, where I was just trying to give an example of a lane continuity issues that we're addressing, but we're also addressing the same issue on the northbound. As you said, there's some little bit of a weird configuration that's not necessarily safe, so we're providing the lane continuity in the northbound.
Thank you for that. And then one thing you'd said, I think, several times about working with city staff. Mm-hmm. Last year you presented, but when I looked at the agenda, it was really more of the OC loop. I don't remember this part coming up. And then to really the city manager, Brett, has OCTA or Caltrans been working with the city on any of these changes other than just a briefing?
It's been briefings over the last 6 months, Stephen, in that range.
But basically it's this, right? A plan view of the changes, is that?
Yeah, our city engineer has been active with them working on alternative 2, 3, and 4. Then earlier this year, I brought some of that information to you guys.
Okay, and I remember that briefing. But you know, we've had some, when you've said you're working with the city, mm-hmm. you know, with the toll lane on the I-405, that really wasn't working with the city. That was really telling the city what you're going to do. And this kind of feels to me the same way. And I really, if you're going to work with us, I would really appreciate your work with the city staff, because this came to me as somewhat of a surprise. Thank you. No other questions.
Okay. I just wanted to mention that Dave Hunt, one of the city staff, has been involved in our monthly project meeting from the previous phase, which was back in 2013. And in the current phase, he's also involved as well.
Thank you.
I'm concerned about the 605 off-ramp on the southbound. When you're southbound on the 605 and you make the big circle, when you enter Catella, mm-hmm. that to me is one of the most unsafe spots in the city, because you're first of all, the cars that are on Catella are coming downhill over the bridge. They're, if they're doing 60, you're lucky, okay, unless the traffic's backed up. But I mean, if it's open, it's very dangerous. And for the person who's making the turn, mm-hmm. they are now going downhill, but looking back, trying to look back over the shoulder to the left. And after 2 o'clock till six, you're in the sun. Mm-hmm. So it's almost like a blind spot there. And sure. I know one of your options is to consider having a dedicated lane there and then only having one dedicated lane mm-hmm. on the northbound side. So I'd really like to encourage you to look into that as much as possible.
Yes.
And take that, mm-hmm. take the dangerous part of the southbound. We can get rid of that. There's room to get rid of that.
Right. Absolutely.
Okay.
And that's
Thank
something
you.
That we're studying right
yes.
now.
Yes. I know it's one of the options.
Yes.
Thank you.
Josh?
I want to say thank you guys for coming out. I know it's the evening, your whole team here, and a lot of work went into this project and study. So thank you guys for presenting something for a solution. Just a couple questions that I had for this. In this plan, are you still planning keeping a HOV on-ramp as part of one of those two plans? Or are they both now going to be metered?
They will be metered because we're signalizing the whole entire intersection.
Okay, so one of the on-ramps currently, one of the lanes is an HOV, the other one is not. Are you can continue to have HOV for one and not the other?
That's something that we're currently studying. As I mentioned, we're doing the more detailed traffic micro-simulation analysis okay. to look at it further and support or validate and confirm our purpose and need of the project and some of the improvements that's proposed.
Okay, so you guys outlaid a lot of outreach. It sounds really great, and you have the project here too, but you know, we're going to try to hopefully sell us to the residents and the community. I think we're going to try to improve traffic. We're going to improve the flow and safety. But how much is this really going to improve before it's back to what we have? I mean, we're going to continue to grow. Mm-hmm. Is this more of a band-aid to fix a problem within 3 years, or are we actually addressing the issue and really investing for a long-term solution?
So the main congestion on the Catella backup is stems from actually the poor operation at the Catella and Los Alamitos intersection. So without addressing that, actually the congestion part of it may not be addressed entirely. However, and per Measure M2 legislation of this project, the improvements are intended to improve access to and from 605 Catella Avenue. So improvements of Catella and Los Alamitos intersection is not as a part of that commitment. And so it's not part of, it would improve the operations of arterials, but it doesn't improve the interchange itself.
Okay. And another question too about loading up on those, say the off-ramp from the 605 North, is you're not adding capacity with inside that. My staff, we work with your local credit union, you know, they battle a lot, but trying to get the school traffic and getting on 605, you know, that's a very long and it's very unsafe because it does back up when the 605 and actual travel lanes. Mm-hmm. So when you talk about not adding capacity, are we really not gonna address the AM traffic that's building up and that sometimes spills into the actual, you know, motorways within those lanes of the 605?
So by adding the second lane to, as you know, the interchange is in the Caltrans right away, as I mentioned earlier, mm-hmm. and by adding the second lane, it's more on the freeway side, so it helps with the mainline queuing, actually.
Okay.
We're looking, as I mentioned, we're doing a little bit more further detailed traffic.
I guess for my part, too, I would hate to go for the trouble for all this public outreach and doing mm-hmm. this to almost, you know, Warren's point, we're saying, hey, this is what we're really going to do. And if this outreach is not going to actually provide substantive change based on the comments from our community, mm-hmm. then why bother going through the expense and hassle instead of actually looking for a solution that's going to for the long term, like 20-year plan to know that if we are going to grow our city and grow community, and if we know we're going to add toll lanes, and if we know we're add a retail development or anything else that's going to really impact this area, mm-hmm. address it holistically instead of just putting a Band-Aid on the issue.
Right. And we've been working closely with Dave Hunt. He's, as I mentioned, he's been coming to our monthly project meeting. So he's been sharing with the city's development plan, which has been incorporated in our traffic studies as well.
Okay. So thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. So again, I would like to thank city staff, Dave Hunt and Stephen Mendoza, for all their involvement and help along this process and this project. So next, I would like to provide an update on West County Connector Replacement Planting Project. Recently, West County a Connector Improvement Project from Valley View 22 to north of 405-605 interchange has been completed, and this is a follow-up project to provide a replacement planting. The construction for replacement planting was initiated back in August of last year, and contractor is currently working on installing some new irrigation system. Contractor began with some cleanup and checking the existing irrigation system throughout the project area. That has been followed by installation of new irrigation system in the 22405 Valley View Street area. The contractor will be moving west towards Seal Beach Boulevard to complete those installation where necessary. Once the irrigation systems are in place, the contractor will move back to Valley View to begin planting, again progressing towards Seal Beach Boulevard. The contractor expects to move to the north end of the project near the 405 and 605 connector in late spring of this year. From there, they will progress south through the connector area and west along the 22 to finish up the work, and which is expected to be completed early next year, 2018. So with that, if you guys have any questions.
Any questions? Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, now oral communications. At this time, any individual in the audience may come forward to speak on any item within the subject matter jurisdiction of the City Council. Remarks are to be limited to not more than 5 minutes per speaker. And please keep in mind, if you're coming to speak on the Village 605 project, we are going to be having a special public hearing on Monday, January 30th at 6:00, where we will also be having public comments if you'd also like to speak at that point.
Hi. Good evening. Mayor Hasselbrink, City Council members. My name is James Davidson. I'm the president of the Westminster Chamber of Commerce. Professionally, I own my own accounting firm in the city of Westminster. I'm a certified public accountant, a certified government financial manager, and a certified fraud examiner. My purpose here this evening is to talk about a subject that I have brought to other city councils in the neighboring cities about the need for all of us to comply with laws and regulations. There is a widely held view among our local citizens that our laws and regulations pertaining to the operations of organizations, primarily businesses, are being ignored to the point of being cavalier about their importance, and that this attitude includes, in some cases, a wink and a nod or a round of laughter or absolute arrogance. These individuals may have a financial pressure and opportunity to commit fraud and a rationalization that doing so is justified. I would like to refer to a biennial report to the nations on occupational fraud and abuse. This is the most recent one this year, or this last year, 2016. This report pertains to topics of frauds committed in organizations. First, as a summary, the existence of fraud makes it more difficult for honest business owners, governments, and tax-exempt organizations to be successful because the cost of fraud must be passed on to customers or to the public as a whole in the form of higher prices. Fraud accounts for about 5% of worldwide revenues of businesses, governments, and tax-exempt organizations, $3.7 trillion a year and a year worldwide. 88% of the total dollar amount of fraud is committed in businesses. 10% of the total dollar amount of fraud is in government. That leaves about 2% of the total dollar amount of fraud committed within religious, charitable, and social service organizations. 88% of the total dollar amount of fraud worldwide and 87% in the United States is committed by managers, business owners, and executives. This means that of $3.7 trillion lost to fraud annually, $2.7 trillion of that amount is shifted from low and middle income individuals to managers, business owners, and executives each year exclusively through fraud. The effect on families. Families with household income of $50,000 per year will lose an average of $2,500 per year as victims of fraud, 5%. In a lifetime of 80 years, calculating the loss beginning at age 20, that is $150,000. And this number does not include any interest that could be earned that would provide additional resources. It is all lost because of the massive amount of occupational fraud committed that steals from them throughout their lifetimes. Primarily low and middle income families are never able to buy a home in their lifetime, exclusively because of the fraud committed against them and the rest of us. In our local communities, I live in the city of Westminster, my business in the city of Westminster. I'm going to give you just a short rundown of a very widely held view of the kinds of frauds that are most frequently committed in this area of Orange County. Significant underreporting of sales and sales tax. Significant underreporting of payroll and payroll taxes. Significant underreporting of self-employment income and self-employment taxes by independent contractors. Significant underreporting of federal and state income tax. Significant underreporting of Social Security that weakens our Social Security system. Significant underreporting of Medicare that weakens our Medicare system. And submittals of fraudulent documents to lenders for loan approval. And that for this evening is where I would like to end my presentation for now. I would like to come back in the future and continue with this topic and pick it up from this point. I thank you very much.
Thank you.
esteemed Mayor Hasselbrink and Mayor Pro Tem Edgar and the rest of the council and staff. Thank you very much for allowing us to speak this evening. My name is Sherry Kropp, and I'm the superintendent for Los Alamitos Unified. And I wanted to talk on two topics this evening. The first one is the median beautification project. I love it. I can't wait till it's beautiful. But I'm asking the council to respectfully delay the start of that project until the summer. If I read it even somewhat correctly, it looks like it's a project that could be done in the summer. And as you know, we also have been working hard on mitigating efforts to mitigate traffic. And so if that project could be delayed till the summer, that makes a big difference than running from May till the end of the June. So I would respectfully ask, if it doesn't impact the city, that delay would mean a great deal to us. The other topic I wanted to just briefly mention was the sign that's coming up. And ours really is, again, I respect the city's right and the necessity to advertise and all of that. We would ask that you consider, we sent a letter about the size and the location of the sign and what it will do to our field. We believe that that's quite an area that will never dry out and could permanently damage that portion of the field. And so, as you know, painfully and personally, we spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on our field. And so we're concerned about that, if we could look at that. And that is it. Thank you very much. And Happy New Year.
Thank you.
Yeah, good evening, Mayor and Mayor Pro Tem, council members and staff. First of all, I'd just like to say thank you to all here involved for your courtesy and for your service. And the first thing I'd like to do is just give a simple thanks to the Traffic Commission for recognizing, I think, the need to lengthen the green light time going south from Walnut to Wallingsford across Catella. It's a great need. I did see it listed as an item, and I'm not sure if it's been fully addressed or not, but I'm glad it's on the list of things that do need to be corrected, because it really, really does need to be corrected. The other reason I'm here is just very, very briefly, and thank you, Mayor Hasselbrink, for mentioning the appeal pending for January 30th, I believe, regarding the Village 605 Center on Catella, right next door here. I think it's regarding concerns with the freeway sign, the environmental impact report, and traffic. And I'm just asking, please, all interested parties, please educate yourselves regarding the issues and attend the appeal hearing. All the information, I believe, is available online one way or another. This is another chance for the public to participate, or if not participating, to just take what they get. And thank you very much for your attention and for your courtesy.
And can you say your name, please?
Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Douglas Smith. I'm your neighbor.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi, my name is Elaine Legere, and I'm here representing Oak Middle School's PTA. Dr. Kropp mentioned the digital sign that's going into the Oak field, and I'm here more to talk about the advertising content that would be going in that digital sign that will rotate every 4 to 8 seconds. And we believe it has the capacity to distract our Oak Middle School students with advertising content during their school day, which we will have no control over. Let me repeat and ask that as a question. Once this sign is built, will the City Council, School Board, Oak Middle School faculty, or PTA have any control over the advertising content that is on that digital board? Let's imagine a typical late morning on a weekday, middle schoolers are out for PE, playing a game of soccer or jog around the track, and the billboard is flashing every 4 seconds, rotating ads for beer tasting, dollar French fries, and lottery scratchers. And we don't even know what other tenants are going in there or whether advertising they will put up there. The point is that once the City Council approves this sign, will we have any control over the content whose most captive audience will be 1,000 of our 11 to 13 year old children? This type of project is not something that we can be proud of. As parent of 2 children in the community, every day I hear the pride of our amazing school system. Los Alamitos Schools are the best in Orange County. They win awards and are recognized nationally. What I'm asking is that the city take extra care in the planning and development of this property and not use Oak Middle School as a mere obstacle in development, but that you plan this property for the betterment of our entire community, including our children and our teachers at Oak. And please take a good long look at this sign and try and consider if we should get rid of it before it's built. Ask yourself if this sign is really necessary. Isn't it a flashy and gaudy example of a property owner interested in their own development and potential revenue, but not the surrounding community and definitely not the children at Oak Middle School? Once the sign is up, it is not going away, even if we decide we don't like it. Please, City Council, represent us, represent our kids, represent quality education, and represent a community that we can be proud of. And please reconsider this digital sign.
I'm Stephen Olveda, representing the Parks, Recreation, Cultural Arts Commission. A little bit of a lighter note here for you. I'm sure you guys are all aware, there is a Council Commission Cup for Race on the Base, based on number of participants, based on the percentage of participants on the Commissioner Council. And we just wanted to make sure we were here to challenge you guys to show up and support the probably the biggest special event that we have in the city. And so I think it's important for all of us commissioners, as well as council members, as well as city staff. I know Corey's going to be there. Him and his staff do a great job putting it on. It's a fun 2 days of running, biking, swimming, all the above. So we want to make sure you guys are all there. I will be there. I'll be beating all of you probably. Respectfully. Respectfully. No, I haven't seen. So, I mean, I'm probably going to eat my shoes after this, but, you know, that's okay.
We'll have you back after that.
Okay. Thank you guys very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. And challenge accepted.
Well, welcome, new Mayor Hasselbrink, to 2017. Incumbent council members and new council member. I think it's going to be a great year. And we're starting it off with a bang. The buzzword, the lightning rod, seems to be land use for 2017. It's been brought up at both ends of the county tonight. I know we're going to bring it up again on the 30th with regard to the 605 Village. I'd like to say just something preemptively. The beauty of institutional memory, I've been in this town a while, plugging away at some of the issues that that confront us and confound us sometimes. One of those issues is our tax base. Years ago, I put our interim mayor, Henry Tobuada, in front of a camera in which he said, we are dangerously upside down in tax base. We have 4, 5, maybe 6 industrial companies in this town that carry 50, 60, 70% of our tax base. Any one of which, the fallout from our loss of them would result in probably loss of police services, et cetera, on down the line. I'm very happy to see that the council has taken an attitude of broadening our tax base out. This is something that the public has been agitating for many years, it seems to be going that way, retail at both ends of the county as opposed to industrial. More trucks on Catella would have been a disaster. I'd like to just say a word, sort of not preemptively, but just in anticipation of the meeting on the 30th regarding the 605 Village. I know it's going to be spoken of at a later time, but I'd like to point something out. In our rush to negotiate with a I'm sure very worthy developer for the development of our retail at the 605 freeway, I think we left a few chips on the table. And I think a couple of those chips that maybe we didn't look at quite adequately, and I listened and watched very closely at some of the previous meetings and staff reports that came forward, I don't think we did an adequate job of identifying pedestrian and otherwise non-vehicular traffic flow. I think we have several opportunities to increase local traffic flow into that new shopping center that would in fact mitigate at least some of the traffic, of the vehicular traffic moving into there, which is what, whose egresses are, as we all know, extremely limited. I'm thinking, for one, we have now and have invested a great deal of time, effort, resources, and treasure into our Coyote Creek Park. An extension of that park, less than a football field, would connect that whole strip of access to the backside of that retail area. I was out there the other day. I paced it off myself. It's a football field long. There is a trail that runs behind the fence at the school, at Oak Middle School grounds, that in fact would lead directly into the back of that shopping center. There were kids out there at the park, which you only see occasionally, on their skateboards, just mulling around. They had nowhere to go. They had no destination. There was no there for them to get to. And I spoke with them a little bit about it, and they all said, hey, that sounds great. Why don't they do that? It's right over there. And it is literally just a football field away. A short extension would get us to that center. Pedestrian access. Let's face it, this is not a Cerritos center. This is not a center with an anchor business that's going to draw thousands of people off the freeway. This is a community center. It may be very desirous. It may be very beautiful. It may be exactly what the people of this community want, but we need access to it. And I think we could put on our thinking caps and do a little better thinking about how to get there without having to get into a car and go there. Our development director spoke of, in response to a question a few sessions ago, how do we get there by foot? Well, you go down past behind the rec department and take a left, and then you go on a little bit ways and go through a fence. I think we can do better than that. I think we need a pedestrian promenade, arboreal type of walkway that will get us, that will invite people to this center. I think we can do a little more thinking outside the box, maybe even alleviate some of the traffic, which is going to be extreme at that 605 bottleneck. And I think that we can have a very wonderful community center with very little additional effort involved. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Jonathan McGaugh. I appreciate the opportunity to address the mayor, Mayor Pro Tem, and the city council, and the officers as well. I live in Rossmoor. I've lived here for 16 years. Before that, I lived in Cyprus for 12 years. And what I'd like to speak to you tonight is something that I just heard tonight, actually. It pertains to the Village 605 Center, but we also heard about OCTA improvements to the 605 on-ramps and connectors. And my main concern is safety and traffic safety, public safety, and the ability to move the traffic in and out of this area in a safe fashion. And I don't know all the details. I haven't read all the environmental impact report of the Village 605, but my gut tells me that if the OCTA improvements that they're talking about are made, it's going to impact the environmental assessment that was done for that Village 605, particularly the westernmost exit out of that shopping center. That coupled with the proposed height of the freeway sign, those freeway signs, we've seen them in Westminster, we've seen them in Cerritos. They're a distraction, they affect night vision. They just don't communicate the values and the character of this community, in my opinion. So I'd like you to reconsider those as well. I'll be at the January 30th meeting, but I wanted to at least stand up and let you hear my concerns of the new proposed improvements and how you intend to integrate those with the Village 605 upgrades. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other comments? Okay, I will close oral communications. And moving on to warrants, do I have a motion?
I'll move them.
I'll second.
Roll call.
Councilmember Kusumoto?
Aye.
Councilmember Murphy?
Aye.
Councilmember Wilson?
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Edgar?
Aye.
Mayor Hasselbrink?
Aye. Consent calendar. All consent calendar items may be acted upon by one motion unless a council member requests a separate action on a specific item.
I'll pull a B, please.
I'd like to pull E.
Which one?
Echo, E.
Anybody else? Do you have a motion for the balance?
I'll move the balance.
Oh, I'm sorry. Hold on. I need to, I'm going to pull C. Motion.
Sorry. Yeah, move the balance.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, Warren will start with B.
So, okay, if I can have just a quick explanation from staff, Brett, on page 11 of 13 of the marked up legislative platform. So on page 11 of 13, Exhibit A, do you see that? The support and pursue legislation that increases the opportunity for Tennessee at the base. Why was that deleted from the legislative platform?
Well, we put it in there to for the possibility of getting the consensus from the council whether to continue on with pursuing that as a project. We have it in there. We've had it in there to support the opportunity, the potential of moving, and we've taken that out and seek council direction on that.
Okay, but we are still trying, right? I mean, or is it pretty? Is it dead? I guess I'm not clear then what you're saying.
It's. I would say it's stalled at this point. We haven't been doing much more with it at this point. We do have a new commander at the base, but we did put that in there in the legislative platform to seek your input.
Okay. Well, I'd like to move that we keep that in there and then move the item for approval. Unless there's any other discussion, Mayor.
I did have a couple other items. Before you want to address. One was just kind of going on to
thank you. Sorry,
rookie mistake.
For the community under community regional platform, specifically the public safety, part of what we discussed in October was marijuana businesses, and the emergency ordinance for that failed. But part of that was restricting, I believe, the ability for cannabis stores to be issue business license with the city. We have a prohibition, but I believe it's about medical marijuana. Starting in January of 2018, traditional recreational marijuana stores could be opened up. I'm not sure if the, I guess council did address that we wanted to bring it back at a certain point. And if that does get addressed and we do want to prohibit it and make it in line with medical marijuana, on the county side, the county is, I guess, believe it, convening a task force to determine whether the unincorporated areas of Orange County will allow those same uses. So if it is a wish just of the council, and if we know that Rossmore is within our sphere of influence, whether we want to make sure we advocate on a countywide level to make sure that Rossmore would not have, you know, ability to access, you know, commercial medical marijuana and cannabis stores that would be directly across from our city and our retail areas. So that was one element, you know, to possibly a discussion to put inside on a county level.
So you want to add on the county level?
What page are you on, Josh? Yeah, is it page 10?
So under the county and state platform, there's page 8.
Okay.
Got it. 13, we can add an additional item that would be support restriction of, or support basically within the Rossmore community, or prohibit cannabis, commercial cannabis usage in line with whatever the city's policy is regarding cannabis businesses.
So really dealing with the supervisors then, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. If that's a friendly amendment, I'd be certainly supportive of that, you know, to include that in the legislative platform.
Okay.
So, and did you have any other?
I guess for my side too, and I guess I would be personally opposed to having the Joint Forces training base with possibly looking at as an allocation based on what the prior Army Corps of Engineers saying about the possibility and what it would take in order to get on the base. I don't think it's feasible for us to look at that as a viable alternative and viable investment to move forward. So I would be in support of keeping the strike as detailed within the platform. So sorry, it's on the opposite side of your warning.
Okay, so my motion is out there, no second, and I think you're gonna then have a different motion.
Well, I think once we get all the feedback, let's okay. See where we're at. Yeah.
So that's my feedback.
All right, and I'll go ahead and second it just to continue on with the discussion.
Thank you.
So I have a couple things. The legislative platform was put in place so that as a city council, we can actually put things in motion without bringing it to the city council to get a vote on it. For example, local control, things like that, where we feel like we're under attack, we can call the city manager or the mayor and say, hey, look, we have an issue. We want to take a position to oppose, support, or be neutral on legislation. Many of us are on county boards. That's helpful too, when at the board level, if you're on sanitation or fire or whatever, to be able to get the city to kind of get behind it. But I think where this legislative platform, I think, failed from my perspective was when we just had an issue next door in Cyprus, and we had a full project in full swing, Measure GG, to redevelop and put 5,000 homes on the golf course or that area over there that ever shuts down. We couldn't even get a letter out to take a position on it. So I think we should, if it's not this year, we should think about potentially opening this up. The way this document's set up is it's set up at the local regional level, then it goes to the state and it goes to the feds. But there's not a lot of opportunity when you've got a real live situation right next door and you can't take an action. And at that point, you have to kind of go through. So I don't know. I think for me, this legislative platform needs some more work in the local area. And again, probably needs to be formulated, and maybe it's something we work on next year. I'm not going to push it. The other thing is that, at the county level, if you're following what's going on, there's a lot of focus right now on trafficking, human trafficking. And I don't see a lot in, I know, Mayor, this is something that you've been very strong about, is I don't see a lot in here in taking positions on human trafficking. And the latest example that I would show that I think is something that we should have been able to very quickly react to is our own assembly member takes a position for decriminalizing for youth under 18 to be so that they don't get arrested. The legislation took a position to say, hey, basically at this point, we're not going to arrest people under 18 that are in a situation for prostitution. I'm on the Casa Youth Shelter board, and in the Casa Youth Shelter, we sit on that board, we see people brought in, and there's a decision point that the police have when they pick people up. They're either criminals or they get brought in to Health and Human Services and get put through the process. That is a timely issue. It got approved. There's a lot of stuff going on. But I honestly think that, when we look at this platform, it's stuff like that is, people that are trying to politicize policy that really is needed down in the trenches, we don't have an ability to react because within our platform, we don't have an area to be able to have this reserve for. So what I'd like to be able to see is maybe something at the county and or the state, because this was a state Senate Bill 1322 that basically took this position where we would be able to take quicker positions when this thing is getting a lot of visibility to tip to say, hey, look, to our assembly member, we may or may not agree with you. And at this point, it starts to paint a picture that some of us that actually spend time outside of being on the city council and running our companies, that things that are actually not needing to be politicized, they need to be actually dealt with. I think this needs to be updated to be able to do that. So for me, I would like to see in here, and again, maybe it's part of the bigger modification, is that we start talking about some of the things that are more consistent at the county and the state level with some of the hotbed items. Our city has the most nonprofits per capita in Orange County. None of our legislation really focuses on it. It's all about local control and economic development. So I don't know. I would like to be able to see something in there to where we can go through. And just if you use as a surrogate the Senate bill for trafficking, where would that go in here? Just staff, from your perspective, when you look at this document, what category? I see here under state platform, page 8 of 13, economic development, environmental quality, public safety and homeland security, revenue and taxation, and transportation and infrastructure, and then but there's really nothing that has to do with some of the priorities there. So and I guess as an aside, and I'd like to have an answer to that, staff, but on the side, I would agree with Warren that I think that we do need to keep provisions in the legislative platform for Tennessee. You know, we don't know what's going to happen to that base in the next 25 years. And right now we learned a lot that there's huge hurdles, but think about this. We just lost our quote tenancy by being a pool partner. We no longer have a real vested interest in that pool after a 20-year lease. And I would hope that we would always be trying to be the city that at least would have the first right to come into a situation at the base if there was ever an opportunity. And if you don't have it in your legislative platform that you're telegraphing how important that base is, if it never was a base in the future, I think that we would be really missing opportunity. And I'd also say, staff, and a message to you is, I'm not sure, you know, this is supposed to be more of the platform from the elected position. So I just thought it was kind of a bold move, just respectfully, to take the tenancy part of it out just on where you guys thought you were at. And I'm glad that we highlighted and talked about it in here. So back to my original question, is there an area in this legislative platform where we would be able to put the more softer social issues that we're trying to deal with in our community?
I think typically if they're softer social issues, they may be more controversial. I mean, we talked about this earlier today. So if it is something that council needs to discuss in more detail that doesn't cleanly and easily fit into an area of local control, or something that is more obvious where we can have the write a letter on behalf of the mayor and it fits into our platform, we have a lot of flexibility in that way. But if it's in a more gray area and it may be more controversial, we try to bring that back to the full council for consideration. Difficulty is the timing, because we may not be able to bring it back for a month, you know, if in between meetings. And so we may want to put some flexibility to either city manager review it with the mayor and mayor pro tem or something along those lines, and give some additional authority that's not based on the full consensus of the council. That may be one tool that we have. But if it's a gray area and it's controversial, staff's going to want to bring it back to the council.
Okay. So the recommendation on stuff like that is to really try to get it on the agenda by getting another council member to help and then get it on the next scheduled
agenda.
That's
typically what we've done if it's fit into gray area, or if it's something where either the League of California Cities doesn't obviously support it or oppose it, then we've brought it back in the past.
Okay. Well, those are my only comments, and I think we should probably have a little bit more debate about joint forces. Like I said, I'm not trying to pick sides. I just want to keep my options open down the road. Thank you.
Well, to Troy's point, can't we come out against human trafficking? I mean, that's not a gray area, I don't think.
Yeah, that would.
Can't imagine the pro-human trafficking lobby is going to.
Yeah, that's it. Just some of these bills are written, it's so arbitrary, it's difficult to seek a clear-cut position. But if it's a position on human trafficking, opposing human trafficking, yeah, that's easily.
I mean, the state safety level seemed to me where it would fit in.
Yeah.
Just a sentence, you know, to do what we can to oppose human trafficking.
Yeah, we could do that.
Yeah.
And, you know, I do agree with Josh that the base is going to be a huge hurdle. But I do think we need to leave the option in there and not you know, signal the base that we're done.
Yeah, we definitely value the partnership. We're just getting at that the difficulty, as alluded to, the Army Corps of Engineers and the obstacles that we have in our way. It may be something that is not attainable at this time, but we possibly could soften that. So we still value the partnership, definitely, of working either on shared services with the Joint Forces Training Base or working on future tenancy issues. We could modify the sentence as well.
Under the right circumstances, I'd be interested. It's just, you know, the hurdles are huge. I mean, I know when we had the meeting with General Reddick's and the whole staff, and the lady from the base spoke,
Cheryl Connett.
Yeah, Connett, that, you know, one of the staff members when we left said, this is never going to happen. I think that was the general consensus at the time. But there's a possibility it will happen. As Troy mentioned, you know, we don't know where the base is going, you know, long term. It's always subject to BRAC or whatever. We need to keep our interest alive there, I think, is my real point.
Yeah, if it's the consensus of the council to leave it in, we can leave it in, and we can, as we're looking at making future modifications to the platform based on your feedback, we can change that sentence and sure. Bring a proposed new recommendation back to the council.
Okay, thank you, Councilmember Murphy, you yielded to me. So, you know, it's like the word I heard, soften. I don't understand what you mean by soften it, and I guess I don't understand what's it poking, number one, the statement. And then number two, I think, as Mayor Pro Tem Edgar said, if there's ever an opportunity such that we would want to send a lot of letters out to congressmen, women, and senators, without this in there, you'd have to bring it back to us saying, should we send a letter, you know, advocating support for us having some, you know, control of something that's in our zip code, something in our city limits, right? I think that's what really this kind of does for us. Otherwise, if you kind of take this away from your tool, then we're in this process of the next meeting. Now we're going to look at a draft letter to send off to the senators and the Congress, you know, the representatives, to say, hey, you know, if this is becoming available, we want our, you know, our claim first. So I don't know what you mean, soften. And it's really not, it's you, it's us, right? That we want this in there, right?
Yeah, if okay. It's, we can keep that in. If it's the consensus of the council to keep it in, we can keep it in 100% as it is.
Thank you. Richard.
So, I mean, something we learned with Josh going through his election, and I would just ask for more feedback, is that when he was running and the other people were running, I did hear adversity specifically to the issue of moving City Hall to the base. And maybe, Josh, maybe your point. And I think what we're saying is maybe historically we're seeing other stuff. You know, some of us have tried to get the fire station on the base as being something. Some of us have tried doing some of the stuff with the Homeland Security or the Public Works. So that tenancy means something a little bit different. I just wanted to make sure you understand where our frame of reference is coming from.
So I'll drop my opposition if we can remove City Civic Center as a specific issue on there and leave it as either city facilities or city items. To Councilmember Edgar's point, you know, one of the main issues I did write about was, you know, the challenges that would have become to move the Civic Center, relocate this, combine it with a larger commercial development, and what it would take in order to be fiscally solvent in order to build and develop on the base. And when speaking with the residents, constituents, you know, that was a no-starter for them. They did not want that. And it was an issue I heard a lot back saying that, you know, we definitely don't want this. But if we're talking about tenancy when it comes down to the pool operations, you know, sharing operations and services of public works, police, fire protection, I'm open to possibilities and absolutely won't want to close off any doors. I just have issues with saying that we're going to locate a civic center and basically, you know, keeping our eyes down and saying, well, we're going to focus on this regardless of the hurdles. If we're going to keep it as a broad open for possible items, let's keep the language broad and not so specific for these items. And I would drop, say, my you know, opposition for it if we want to keep it broad.
I'm not used to going last here. it's kind of odd. I agree. I don't want to close that door of tenancy. Richard and I did attend a number of meetings, and right now the hurdles seem insurmountable, but never say never. It could happen. So I would just like to do the tenancy and partnership, because that's just keeping, I mean, let's make it really broad. Because you never know what they would offer us. I mean, leadership changes there every 3 years, and you just never know what's going to happen. So I would like to keep it a little bit broader. And then also getting back to Troy's comments, you know, I don't think we've added a category here for quite some time. And I think over the past 5 to 10 years, there's a number of social issues now that have become pieces of legislation. And it might not be a bad idea to add a category of just social issues that would involve, you know, human trafficking, homelessness, cannabis, massage, I mean, any number of things that we want to retain local control that we put in the county, the state, and the federal levels. I think that's a no-brainer as far as what we would feel comfortable as a group opposing or supporting based on those social issues. I don't think 5 years ago we weren't having these discussions about human trafficking in Los Alamitos, and now we are. So I think we we do need to be time sensitive and being able to respond within a day with some emergency legislation or however you may have it. And I think we're giving you the ability to do that. So we have a motion.
Well, I think the motion has been probably, I'm going to withdraw it and then kind of let you phrase one that kind of wraps everything up. Will that be okay?
Sure.
So I'll withdraw my motion and let someone else make the motion and encompass all the nature of the discussion.
Do you have somebody want to take a crack at it?
I think we're making a motion to ask staff to go back and to go through, make some of the minor changes, look for an area that potentially we can deal with some of the social issues, and just bring this back maybe for the consent calendar for the next city council meeting.
Yeah, let me just clarify the direction that we have so far so we can incorporate that into our changes that we bring back. So we'll, and I won't say soften, but we'll modify the sentence regarding the tenancy on the base to incorporate the comments that the council has given us tonight. And we will consider adding a category of social issues that would take into account things like nonprofits and human trafficking and other examples that you've given. And we will consider, we'll put a statement in to consider supporting the Orange County or Rossmore if they want to evaluate cannabis at the local level. Is that something the consensus of the council to bring that back as part of this platform or something along those lines?
Can I ask on that, Warren? So the sphere of influence issue is the point, or I think it was
Josh.
I mean, the sphere of influence is a matter of fact. They are in the sphere of influence. We're just trying to maintain consistency. I think, you know, Councilmember Wilson has picked cannabis as a specific example, but I think in general, we are trying to, you know, have some consistency. So I definitely would support that.
Yeah, we incorporate that into it. And then it may not be at the next time we bring it back, but based on Mayor Pro Tem Edgar's feedback, more analysis of at work at the local and state level. And you gave the example of the Senate bill. So we'll take that into account when we bring that back. Probably that would be next year. The other ones we'll bring back sooner than that to you as a consent calendar item.
Yeah, that's the motion.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And item C, I pulled that. I don't need a staff report. I just wanted a clarification. We received three quotes back in November. The two that are not being recommended to award had expiration dates of December 15th, December 30th. The one that is being recommended did not have an expiration date. Can we just confirm that that price is valid from last year's quote?
Yes, Mayor Hasselbeck, we did bring that and took it back to the Chief Nunez and Captain Connolly. They looked at it. The two, I think they were analyzing it at the time when it was not expired, the other two, but the one that's being recommended does not have an expiration date. We were able to confirm that tonight.
So I'll make a motion to go ahead and approve item C.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
And Mayor Pro Tem E.
Yeah, I mean, it wouldn't be a good council meeting if I didn't pull something on Coyote Creek, so I just wanted to check that one off. So this is item 9E, which is basically the city's going out to bid to do the new bike path at Coyote Creek. I really don't have anything other than just thanking staff. You know, if you knew the hurdles they had to go through, and everybody that's had to listen to this for the last year and a half up here is definitely glad that it's probably almost over. But again, thank you. And Stephen and David, thank you so much for.
Yeah, thanks to David and Stephen for staying with it all the way through.
Yeah, and so once this goes to bid and they'll actually start doing the bike path to finish off the Cody Creek path, you know, we're on a good timeline here finally. Thank you.
Yes.
And I did have one quick comment. Once again, I'm not used to going last, so I was going to pull this too. It's basically just, can we make sure that we let the Royal Oak HOA know when the construction's going on? Some of those mobile homes are about 5 feet from the bike path, and the sound of grinding asphalt and the smell of paving, just to be good neighbors, and also the school district as well, just so they know what's going on.
Yeah, sure. We will.
Do I really need to close it? I'm not adding anything to this. I just, or I guess we got to approve it.
Right.
So I'll
right.
go ahead and make a motion to approve as read.
Second.
All in favor? Again.
All in favor?
Yeah. Aye.
Aye. I'm sorry.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Okay. Item T, public hearing. This is approval of plans and specifications and authorization to bid for Los Alamitos Boulevard Median Improvement Project. We're going to open it to public hearing. So any public comments?
Point of order. Mayor, I have a conflict of interest. I have asked FPPC for a letter of opinion as my employer is on the boulevard, and pending that opinion, I'm going to evoke a conflict of interest and recuse myself from the meetings.
Okay.
Thank you.
Oh, we do staff. I'm sorry. We do staff report first.
Yes.
Thank you.
Steven Mendoza, Development Service Director. We'll do a brief staff report on this item.
Thank you, Madam Mayor and members of the City Council. Beautifying Los Alamitos has been a goal of this. Los Alamitos Boulevard has been a goal of the city since 2010, when we first started the introduction of the Commercial Corridors Plan. And then we solidified those goals in our city's general plan. The beautification of Los Alamitos Boulevard begins with the raised center medians. If I could direct councils, the cameraman, and the audience's attention to this site plan, this concept plan up here. This is what is in City Council's packet. This is the latest concept plan that is presented before you. The configuration of the median islands has not changed since the old public hearings that we've had on this and the old outreach meetings. Plant types have been adjusted and tree types have been adjusted. The project has been designed to achieve a few things: a safer, calmer, greener Los Alamitos Boulevard. The series of raised median islands consist of landscaping, lighting, banners and decorations, signage, an offset crosswalk, and the median placement has been placed at all of the streets possible and feasible within the project. And I'll give you a little bit of a summary on some of those items that have been incorporated, because I know some of the audience members may not know much about this project. The concept plan mounted shows selected paved surface materials, plant materials, and the irrigation systems. Trees have been included to beautify and calm traffic by making the road appear narrower. You'll have a series of trees that are both single trunk and multi-trunk. Your lighting has been selected that complements the gas lamps used in both the Old Town neighborhoods. As you know, this Los Alamitos Boulevard goes right through the middle of Old Town East and Old Town West. We didn't want to ignore those two neighborhoods in the planning of this, so the lights have been incorporated to complement those lightings. And on those lightings, we've had proposing banner arms for future decorative banners in the city. The banners will be incorporated into the design to ensure that year-round banners, as well as holiday or special event banners, will be accommodated. There'll be a signage included within the raised median that has been incorporated in a way to direct visitors to shopping and dining opportunities, not advertising individual businesses, but saying the words shopping and dining on the boulevard, and also to ensure people know where to get to places of interest, like the post office, the high school, and things like that. So it'll be mainly used for those purposes. It'll have an offset crosswalk. It'll have a crosswalk that doesn't go straight. You turn right when you're in the middle of the crosswalk, which allows you to face the oncoming traffic. It forces that pedestrian to look at the traffic that's driving towards them before they continue in the next leg of the boulevard. The proposed median island placement will channelize left-hand turn lanes and create a unique and visual identity to the corridor. The median islands will be helpful in reducing conflicts between the pedestrians and automobiles that exist there today. I don't think there's anyone in this room that would disagree that when you drive out to the center median to turn left from a shopping center or some of the streets, you're not sure where traffic is coming from when it comes at you. Ganal is one of the best examples. You're not quite sure if that guy turning left is coming at you or going the same direction as you. And this reduced those conflicts. And if you remember the graphic that was used in the outreach meetings, it had all the multicolored arrows going in all kinds of directions. Well, this eliminates that confusion. Although implementation of this proposed median would result in some redistribution of vehicle trips, the analysis conducted in the environmental document concluded that the intersections along Los Alamitos Boulevard can accommodate the added turning movements and traffic volumes resulting from the installation of these raised center medians. Adequate left turn pockets have been incorporated into the project design to provide storage space for the additional vehicles making the left turns and U-turns. Now I'd like to talk about some of the outreach that we've done on this project. As you know, we've talked about this since 2010, but we got really serious into the funding aspect and designing aspect in 2015 with discussions at the City Council level in January, February, September, and then again in May of 2016, we had a few meetings. And then finally, if you remember, we conducted an open house over at the Recreation Department on June 6, 2016. After that point, Council gave us the go-ahead of using this design and starting the traffic analysis and environmental work necessary to bring this project forward. On many of our public works construction projects, we're not required to study CEQA because it's just maintenance of projects or repaving projects. Those are usually exempt from CEQA. But this took a little more of a study. The person that authored the traffic analysis is here in the room. His name is Rich Barreto. He'll be here if you have any questions regarding the traffic information in the analysis. For tonight's meeting, we have advertised this in the News Enterprise on December 7th. And then on December 12th, we mailed notices to 30 public agencies. On December 8th, we mailed notice to tenants along the project. And then on December 6th, we posted notices at the museum. And then in addition, we hand-delivered notices to 86 businesses along the boulevard within 500 feet of the project during the lunch hour. The reason we did that extra step, we were getting a lot of mail returned to us from the post office undeliverable. So we just took that extra step to do a hand delivery as well, so Council would be confident in that we did the most we could to notify everyone 500 feet from the project. Our next step is to bid out the project, receive the bids. There may be an opportunity to look at those bids. The City Council will be faced with that opportunity, hopefully as early as next month, with the bids, and then we will, depending on the cost of some items, we may have to pick and choose some items that are either affordable or not affordable based on our budget constraints. But that is not for tonight. That's for our future opportunity. With that, I wanted to introduce the team that helped along with this project. Of course, Dave Hunt, our city engineer, Tyrone Peter, who is the designer of the project, Rich Barreto, who's our traffic consultant, and then Bob McMahon is our landscape architect, and Bob also worked on the Seal Beach Center median, so we brought him aboard to help us with this to provide some continuity between the two cities. With that, this is a public hearing. You're probably wondering why it's a public hearing. It's because the environmental document that's attached to it. Want to take any public testimony on that environmental document, and this will give you the opportunity to do so. With that, I'll turn it back to the mayor, and if it would be appropriate to open the public hearing, take any public testimony.
Actually, at this time, it's been requested that we take a quick recess.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry, for 10 minutes, and then we'll come back and go right into public hearing, public comment. Okay, we're going to call the meeting back to order.
Yep. Public comment.
There we go.
You ready?
You ready?
We have a traffic commissioner over there. That's cool.
Yeah.
Randy.
Okay, we're
Commissioner Hill.
Come on back. Okay, so we're in the public hearing, and we're opening it now up to public comments.
Good evening. My name is Sandy Yavitz. I am one of the owners of Center Plaza. I think you have received a letter from one of my partners. And we very much appreciate the median along Los Alamitos. We've owned this project for over 10 years, and we understand the need for it. But what our concern is, we have over about 20 tenants in the center, and all of our left-hand turn has been eliminated coming in and out of the center. We're not as concerned with a left turn out, but we would like to request for traffic traveling southbound that we obtain a left-hand turn in. What this plan is doing is requiring everyone that is traveling south to make a U-turn at, I believe it's Catalina, to come into our center, and then anyone going southbound coming out has to go up to Sausalito, Brigham, and make a U-turn to go south. So we're at least requesting consideration for a left-hand turn in. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Afternoon, evening, Mayor, Pro Tem, and council members and staff. My name is Ken Tipton. I'm the owner of ABC Pools with my wife. We're on Los Alamitos Boulevard. We've been there a couple of years. I love what you're doing. It saves a lot of headaches for us because we tell people don't make a left out of our driveway. Go make a U-turn. Shoot, make a left every time. And Taco Surf, the same thing. People will be making a left to shoot across there, and we're trying to make a right, and we're constantly having button heads. So this is going to be great for us. The only thing I would like, which is three items that you should really consider a lot because we've gave it a lot of thought, is doing on Cerritos and LaSalle, right there by the school, doing a scramble cross instead of a crosswalk like this. They can go any way they want, and then it stops them. Because with the scramble, that would stop the kids to the point that you cannot make a left for nearly 45 minutes, or right, rather, and the traffic backs up to where we can't get out for 45 minutes to an hour. The same thing in the afternoons. But if it had the scramble there, cars could make the right. They wouldn't have to worry about the kids. Cars could make right on all four corners and not have the problems that they're having now. Right now, our traffic will go all the way back to Sandy's business, which is past another light, past us. So, I mean, it has really, really been miserable for years. And if you can't do that one, then I'd like to have some white marks in the street to where it says, do not block driveways, which, unless there's an officer there, it's going to be a waste of time, but it's still, we'd try to be able to get out. And but other than that, put your plants in, put your islands in, and it's going to beautify our end of the Los Alamitos Boulevard way better than the other end. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? Okay, we're going to go ahead and close public comment and bring it back to the council. Troy?
I just want to reiterate what Steve Mendoza said, our public works director, is that this project and this first step is something that's been, I think in 2006 I started on the council, we were talking about trying to do something like this. 2009 we secured regional funding, and then we have had public discussions, we've taken public testimony, we've reevaluated over and over, and I think we've tried to be safe. I think that something that we need to think about, I know that Sherry Kropp, the superintendent of Los Alamitos, came up. She talked about timing, talked about kind of the business, making sure that we have, we're not picking winners and losers out there. But probably the biggest thing that I'm concerned about is timing. When we refinanced the park, we put together a bond package that basically started a clock that we took some money out of that to try to start to put this together. And this is just one piece of about a $10 to $12 million project. This is the infrastructure to get this process going called beautification. So I'm definitely sensitive to the school district and their needs. I'm also kind of concerned that, now that we've got this thing formed up and that we're able to get at this point tonight, what tonight is the actual, after all of this public testimony, and we've went back and forth a couple times, we're directing staff to go out and bid the construction to get it done. And so I've been up here a long time. A lot of times somebody will come in and go, Troy, why are you rushing this? And it's like, I'm not rushing. I've been waiting for 8 years. I really do want to kind of get through and get this right. I want to be sensitive to the businesses. I'm definitely familiar with, all of that, and I know the kids. I think the scramble idea was something interesting. I don't know how that works on the signalization, and maybe we can talk a little bit about that, but I would just say Tonight is a really big night, I think, for some of us that have been following this for a long time. I just want to thank staff for really working and staying diligent. And, you know, we've been through a lot of council changes. Councilmember Kusumoto and myself have quite honestly battled back and forth through some really dark times. And it feels good to be here. I don't want to make a big deal about it because, right, it's just plans and a medium. But if you look at it structurally, we hope that it's more than that. It's trying to plant the ideas and business owners like these that are in this room that please invest in your business. We want to invest in the city, and together we'll make this part of LaSalle really beautiful, and we'll improve that the type of businesses that can go in, because we know the demographics support these types of businesses that are here, and we'll continue to bring value to these property owners, and then selfishly tax revenue into the city to try to help provide all the services. So I think with that, I mean, other than technical issues of talking through, I'm just very glad, and I really appreciate staff's work on this. Thank you. That's all I have.
Richard? Yeah, I'm actually very excited about this, too. I think it begins continues the redevelopment of our business district. And I do have a question for staff about trees in the median. And just, is that something we're going to be able to contain long term, are they going to outgrow their usefulness?
Stephen can answer, but the species that have been selected are keeping that in mind.
Yeah. Bob, would you like to come on up and talk about the types of trees and how they grow and how we have to prune them?
Hello, Mayor and Council members. So there are a variety of different tree types. The median varies in planter width about 12 to 14 feet, so that's a pretty generous area. Most of the trees in the palette are more of an upright growing branch pattern, not very evasive with the root systems, and we also have a root barrier that basically runs parallel to the back of the decorative curb edge where the maintenance people will walk on. So for the most part, the trees in the palette, as well as the shrubs, pretty durable, low water use requirements. And there's nothing that's that aggressive, if you will.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
I think my part of my question is, are the trees something we need to have? Are they going to add something?
I mean, it's part of the beautification, the landscaping, but as he said, with drought tolerance in mind and site distance in mind and safety, and not trees that have significant roots that are going to grow out of control. That's definitely a part of it.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
So Ms. Yavitt that spoke about that the turnout or the lack of a turnout, is it something that can be looked at? And I guess the traffic engineer, maybe, did you study that?
Good evening, Mayor Hasselbeck and the other city council members. My name is Rich Barreto, principal with Lynn Scott Law and Greenspan Engineers, engaged by the city to look at the impacts of the project. A little background on the project. At the get-go, one of the things we did look at was all the driveways and the volumes that they do generate. One of the things we wanted to specifically focus on was the design of it, to make sure that volumes with all these driveways being restricted to right in, right out at certain locations, if the left turn movements can be accommodated via the U-turns at upstream or downstream. And in fact, one of the other things we looked at is also service levels, to make sure that they met the city's criteria of LOSD or E in the case of Catella and Los Alamitos Boulevard. Relative to this situation, I believe the driveway in question is almost in close proximity, if not right where the pedestrian crossing is. So if you start to look at something like that, something's going to have to give. We didn't look at that what is going to give, because that's not part of the project description. One of the things we're looking at was specifically what the project was being proposed. And as proposed, from a flow standpoint, an access standpoint, looking at, again, traffic volume north and south on Los Alamitos between Cerritos and Catella, the answer is the volumes and the projected service levels would remain at a situation where the project in itself would not have an impact. Service levels would be maintained at a good service level, with the exception of one location, which was Catalina at Los Alamitos Boulevard, for which a improvement a mitigation measure plus a couple options were identified. So we did not look specifically at each one of these driveways on the what-if scenario. We looked at all the driveways, treating them exactly the same as being proposed, right in, right out, and looking at key intersections up and down the boulevard to make sure that, one, service levels could be maintained, two, left turn, U-turn volumes could be accommodated at that location such that the left turn pockets would be sized appropriately, and then to the point of what the purpose of the project, beautification, median, and landscaping, make sure that there was enough room in there that you could actually plant some trees and do some landscaping from that standpoint.
So I guess my question is a little bit different, though. So then you're talking that you have a design specification and criteria, and so you've met that. So maybe my question is better directed at staff in terms of, on that specific driveway, you said traffic counts, ingress, egress, correct?
Right.
And so there's some number that driveway accommodates, but really it's the left turn or lack of a left turn pocket that is now taken up by landscaping, which is not you're designing to a specification, right?
And we're evaluating the project as proposed,
right there. And so maybe then to staff is why not a left turn pocket there? And you know, in terms of, does the traffic count, would a U-turn be safer than a left turn?
Well, that's a different question. Each U-turn and each left turn is a different situation.
Understand.
Along the boulevard.
But think about the traffic count that wants to go in that driveway, mm-hmm. right? And then southbound and then making a U-turn at Catalina, is that safer, equal to, or less safe than a left turn if a left turn pocket existed there?
I think you might have to say it again for Rich.
I think I understand I understand your question. Now, is it, again, I'll talk general, right? Is it easier to make a left turn or a U-turn?
I'm talking safety.
Or is it
safer? I'm talking safety, yeah.
Well, it's essentially the same movement, right? They're essentially making a left turn across two or three lanes of traffic, whether they're continuing on to the side street or U-turning to continue. So the movement essentially is the same. It's a left turn movement. I'm not sure statistically if there's any information out there, but intuitively what it's telling me as a traffic engineer, based on my experience, the movement's the same.
Okay, understand that. So really then the safety comes down to, at Catalina and Los El Boulevard, there's a green arrow, right, that will, a protected left.
Catalina and Los El Boulevard is an unsignalized intersection under the project's current design. Catalina and Los Al, is that what you're talking about?
Oh, I'm talking Florista, that's right. I'm the wrong intersection.
Correct.
You're correct.
So they do have two opportunities, whether they're making a left turn at Catalina or a left turn at Florista.
I was in the wrong location.
You can't make a U-turn there.
So then it will not be a protected left turn at Catalina, southbound on Los Al, nor will it be a protected U-turn. It's just a left turn.
It's what you experience today. Anyone along the boulevard now can make a left turn out of that two-way left turn and make a U-turn or a left turn under an unprotected move.
Okay. And then the traffic that wants to go into Center Plaza, that area, would then make a left turn at Catalina.
They can make a left turn or a U-turn, correct. Depending on, I'll talk general. If you know where you're going, you're making a left turn, may go around the horn. If you don't know where you're going, you may have to U-turn and double back, right? Because you can make your way around there.
Okay.
But the point I was saying is that we didn't look at it specifically at any of these specific driveways to independently look at the implication, because that's not what we were asked for. We're asked to take a look at the city's proposing a project, beautification project. Tell us, will it work or won't it work? Okay. The answer is yes, it will work. The point I made earlier is that if you start to consider specific left turn access at not only this driveway, but other driveways, something's gonna give, meaning the median's gonna go away. In this case, it's in the proximity of where the proposed PED crossing is. It literally, I think the driveway in question is just north of it. So close proximity to there. So, and I think from the spacing, and I'm going off memory and I looked at it real quick, I think spacing wise between Catalina and Sausalito, it's about roughly 700 feet, and the PED crossing is somewhere midpoint. And I think I was going off what the concept plans that or design plans were.
So then I guess in the abstract, right, as far as a question, there would be no, negative impact if a left turn pocket were to be designed to the median, to turn into that center plaza. From being able to handle the car trips and hold enough of the cars that might be turning from southbound Los Al Boulevard into that plaza. Would that be a fair statement?
When you say negative impact, do you say negative impact from the traffic flow or to the project or
traffic
changing
flow.
The project?
Traffic flow.
So from that standpoint, not knowing exactly what the volumes are and knowing what the spacing would be, you could probably get away with doing it, but we'd have to make sure that the left turn pockets in the northbound direction and into the site could actually do it. Because now you'll have a physical barrier for which they would have to actually queue, right? So once you actually do something, so say for instance, now to make that left turn pocket into the site or any of the other driveways, the northbound left turn pocket at the upstream signal would get short. So now you don't have the ability to accommodate those volumes going in the northbound direction, which means now they're queuing into the lane and into the through traffic. Whereas currently today, depending on how things work out, they're queuing in the two-way left turn lane.
Northbound onto Sausalito, I think it is. Is that what you're talking about? So that is pretty much designed to handle the volume in terms of holding cars that are turning left.
Correct.
That's the capacity, right. And that's okay. So
right.
So that would be a trade-off or
shortening the pocket to allow a left turn pocket into a driveway or another. So again, we didn't look at those specifically, but those are the trade-offs that you're looking at. That something's going to give. The median's going to give. If you're putting a left turn pocket, maybe the ped crossing's not there. Maybe the left turn pocket in the northbound direction gets shortened. From that sample.
Okay. All right. Okay. Thank you very much. I appreciate the input. And then another question for Stephen on this. Mm-hmm. So, I think when the hospital specific plan came about, there was, you had brought up the need for permeable versus non-permeable surfaces. So doesn't the median then add permeable surface, correct?
Those words are so hard to use.
This allows
a place for water to go where it doesn't go down.
Does that then give you some mitigation in other places where you don't need as much permeable, so we can actually trade that for other, maybe more parking?
No, it doesn't do that.
Darn.
Water displaces water, and they're working on big things in South Orange County. But capturing water here doesn't create a bank for a private property owner.
No. Yeah, I'm not talking. It's just running off, right? It's runoff. It's,
yeah.
It's preventing it from running on the streets to the gutters, right? That's what this does.
We're going
right.
to capture more of it now.
Yeah, so then will we then not have to capture it, or, we can allow runoff somewhere else is really my question.
In a public project, yes. A private project, no.
Okay, thank you. With that, no other questions.
I did have a question on the study for the traffic for the drive-ins on traffic in, traffic out. When was that done?
Data collection was done early part of June, because when we first got authorized on this, the whole issue of like schools going out, we had to make sure we were dating collection when all the schools were in session. So they were done when schools were in session.
So it was just recently. Absolutely. Not when this. Okay.
Yeah, correct.
Absolutely. So it does include the because that plaza, that center plaza, has probably changed the most on the boulevard out of all shopping centers, with the addition of Brew Kitchen, uh-huh. CrossFit. A lot, there's a lot more people in that. So that was all taken into
yes.
account of.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And then Stephen, I had a question on the timeline.
Sure.
Right now we have it, start of construction is March 1st and end of construction is June 19th, which just happens to be the first day of summer vacation.
Mm-hmm.
Last day of school is June 15th. What's the realistic timeline? Is this really going to happen in 3.5 months? And I'm just leading up to the question of what's the possibility of moving this to accommodate a summer schedule and still being able to finish on time for our bond obligations to have to spend this money in a certain time?
Well, realistically, this probably is a very realistic schedule, pending weather. It's always pending weather, and especially when we get started with the weather it's like when they first start digging. The construction of the project would be a delay. It would be a delay that we couldn't guarantee it would be done by the time school got back in session. So I think when the schedule that we've included has captured spring break, and it's captured a little bit of extra time to go into the summer months. As we know, construction projects rarely finished on time. We've seen a bad scenario with the water district. They went from an 8-month project to a year-long project. We want to avoid that, but there's no guarantees this will be done by June. There's no guarantee if we started June 19th, we'd be done by the time school was back in session. So we are starting on the earliest possible date that we can do by the time we bid this and get this project underway as soon as possible to get this project moving to beat the deadline that Jason has on the funding. We have multiple public works projects going on every year. We have to fit this project in with many of our other projects that we're doing in the city. As you know, we've got the bridge repair, we've got Coyote Creek, and then we move right on to this. So our scheduling is also for resources that we have available to us. So a lot of thought went into this schedule and creating it around the school schedule as well to be sensitive to that, but to also meet the council's needs of getting this project underway.
Okay. I just want to be sensitive, and you know, it looks like if you just take the schedule and move it to start on June 19th, it'd be done around September 1st, which I know is after school starts, but the heavy construction, the ugly part of it, is going to be done during the summer.
Yeah.
Could you also explain lane closures versus traffic rerouting?
Sure.
And the two lanes?
We really don't think that lane closure is going to be a major part of this. I'll tell you why. Each side of Los Alamitos Boulevard is very wide. You have two very wide traffic lanes, and you have a parking lane, right-hand turn lane in various areas. That gives us a lot of freedom to redirect traffic around this project and still keep those two lanes moving. So I don't want to use the word closure. I'd rather say that we could make sure that we design the best possible traffic plan to mitigate around the, not the trench, but you know what I mean, the construction zone. We may eliminate some parking on the side, but we're not going to eliminate a lane of traffic.
So we'll still have, during this whole construction, we will still have two lanes each way on La Salle Boulevard, just as we have now.
Yeah, it may veer to the right as you go around it on both sides, the west side and the east side, and may veer to the right towards the curb at times, and then move you back away from areas where they're digging. Okay. And then, of course, when a backhoe is backing up, you may have a short timeout with a flagman out there stopping traffic temporarily. But lane closures are not going to be part of this project.
Okay. And when we do award this bid, how much is the contractor going to be able to dictate the start schedule, or is this a firm?
This is firm. Dave's going to be pretty stubborn about this schedule and keeping an eye, especially the start date. If you start being flexible at the start date, that's where you lose it. Where we could have some problems is finalizing the contract. We could lose a week or two in finalizing contract and getting that to the city council in time for approval. If they hesitate on signing the contract. But we've selected a very feasible schedule and offers all the mitigation we can possibly give to keep this project moving forward and to keep traffic moving on La Salle Boulevard during construction.
Okay. Great. Anybody else?
I'm ready to make a motion.
Okay.
I have a few more questions, sure. If I could. Okay.
Yeah.
Jason, when's the deadline for the bond money to be spent?
Basically September 1st of 2018, so about 19 months away.
Okay. To our expert, I joke about the council, I always joke that we argue with the experts, and here I'm going to be doing it, but I can't agree with you that a U-turn and a left turn are the same thing. You cannot accelerate a U-turn. You're still in the middle of the turn. Most cars don't have the capacity to do that. Whereas we've all gunned it when we realized we shouldn't have made the left turn in the first place. I think that I can see problems at Catalina is what I'm getting at in two regards. One is, since we're going to drive traffic to the U-turn on Catalina, people coming from the Ganal side of Catalina, trying to make a left onto the boulevard, I'm concerned about sight lines if there are too many trees in the way right there, and also they're battling the U-turns who are going to be there. We're comfortable, Stephen, on the that's not going to become a choke point? Or a safety point?
We are with the mitigation that's incorporated in the document by restriping Catalina to create that avenue to do that. Okay. You'll lose some parking on Catalina, but you'll see in one of the designs in there, it allows a restriping of Catalina. The other choices of mitigation was a full-blown signal here, and we thought cost would be prohibitive to that.
Okay. Now, if we needed to, we could, if we think we made a mistake down the road, we could put a signal in there.
Yeah, our jobs are to monitor traffic all the time. We have a very active traffic commission that's looking at intersections that were built years ago and always offering modifications to things that have been constructed. It's not unusual to modify something after a project because Los Alamitos habits change, Los Alamitos traffic change, and future development may impact it.
Okay, thank you.
I'd like to make a motion for staff recommendation to read, I guess, would be to adopt the resolution 2017-01, the resolution Los Alamitos City Council adopting the mitigated negative declaration, the mitigation monitoring reporting plan for Los Alamitos Boulevard median project. Item three, to approve the plans and authorize staff to advertise and solicit the bid proposals.
Have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
On to item 10B, introduce ordinance number 2016-09, continued consideration of general plan amendment and zoning map amendment for 4411 Catella Avenue. Staff report.
Thank you, Madam Mayor and members of the City Council. Ordinance 2016-09 is a continued consideration to change the general plan designation and the zoning designation for 4411 Catella Avenue. This is a 28-acre site where Arrowhead is located at the intersection of Lexington and Catella. This change would amend the general plan designation from planned industrial with a retail overlay to retail business. And then it would amend the zoning code or the zoning map from planned light industrial with retail overlay to straight general commercial or CG. These changes are consistent with the 2035 general plan goals and the desires of the community. And as council may remember, this suggestion and recommendation was initiated by City Council in March of 2016. The council asked the Planning Commission to take a look at this potential change, and the Planning Commission took a look at it and provided you a recommendation of approval based on their actions. This hearing was first noticed on June 29th. It was put in the paper for July hearing, and then it was continued several times until we are here tonight. I want to kind of take you back and remember that the Planning Commission had a little bit of a soft spot for Arrowhead and wanted to make sure they were excluded from the non-conforming section of the code. So one of the recommendations to you was to add the following language to the ordinance to ensure that if they were as a user, they could expand their use, provided, however, that the current use upon the property shall not be subject to the city's non-conforming use provisions to the extent that it wishes to expand to other portions of the property. And with that, staff would recommend that the City Council open the public hearing, take public testimony, and then follow staff's recommendation. I think you do have a speaker, and you also have a letter of correspondence that was sent to you before tonight's hearing that you have at the dais. With that, I'll turn it back over to the mayor.
I'm open now for public comment. Anybody wishing to speak on this item?
Good evening, Madam Mayor. How are you? And members of the City Council, I'm Susan Horry, representing JCB Inc. We are the owners of the property located at 4411 Catella. And as Mr. Mendoza mentioned, in 2015, the city adopted a new general plan. During that process, there was, as you recall, extensive community outreach and study by the Planning Commission as well as the council. And the Arrowhead site was carefully studied. In fact, it was identified as being one of the properties within the city to be studied. And in terms of that general plan process, the city ultimately decided to retain the light industrial land use designation and impose a retail overlay on this site because they felt that that would be the appropriate way to address the protection of the existing businesses on the site while being able to look forward to future development opportunities. We believe that that existing general plan and zoning provide the city with the flexibility that it seeks to retain existing businesses while yet also encouraging new development. And so we would request tonight that you basically make no changes to the zoning. I think it's helpful to consider the context of when this amendment was first initiated back in March of 2016. As Steve mentioned, at that time, an application had been filed to develop an industrial building with 14 truck docks on that site. And I know that that gave rise to a lot of concerns. Also at that time, the city's zoning code permitted a number of uses in the light industrial zone that had the potential for also generating substantial truck trips. Since that time, the application has expired. It's no longer on file. And the city also, at your October hearing, took action to eliminate two types of industrial uses from the industrial zone, which generate truck traffic. And so as a result of that, in light of the changes, we don't believe that changing the general plan at this time is warranted. And in fact, what we believe is that the most opportune time for reconsidering this general plan amendment, if you choose to do that, would be once the zoning code study that the city has undertaken has been completed. I think it's also important to understand that imposing an exclusively retail land use designation on this site will not result in the development of retail so long as Arrowhead is there. I think we submitted a study in terms of the highest and best use prepared by the Concord Group that basically talked about the fact that because of the Arrowhead facility fronting on Catella, if this site were zoned for retail, it would be very difficult for retail to be developed on that back site. I think the other thing that I wanted to mention, and I see my red light is going off, that if any development proposal were to be submitted for this site, that it would have to come before the Planning Commission as well as the City Council. Environmental review would have to be done, and certainly at that point the city could address the compatibility of any proposed use with the surrounding community. So given all of these considerations, we request the city to retain the existing general plan and land use designation and not make any changes at this time. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? I'll close for public comment and bring it back to the council. Anybody would like to start? No comment? Richard?
I'll start. I think this is actually kind of a holdover from that's dragged on, that we're no longer really on this path. We've gone a new path where we've taken a step back. We've looked at having zoning consultants, redo the plan. We've passed several ordinances to stop the most onerous uses already. And I really think that this is kind of a dinosaur at this point, that the course we should be on is to wait until we get the consultant's report back for a comprehensive zoning look and then tackle a problem at that time. I think that when they put the retail overlay, I can't imagine that there was ever a thought that the back part of the property was going to be sold first. And I haven't had one person tell me that this would make a good retail spot. It just doesn't make sense to me in that regard. So I would say my course of action is to wait till the consultants are here and then look at this issue again. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. So I will respectfully disagree with Councilmember Murphy on this one. I think that when we go back to the long 3 or 4 year process for the general plan, I think the community spoke very clearly as to what they desired. And as you know, like we talked about, or we will talk about in the public hearing, this site over here behind us was zoned the way it is. And the thought with the retail overlay is exactly how Ms. Horry had talked about. It would be there until, if that ever comes today, that Arrowhead should decide that they no longer want to have that business here, then we will then have that opportunity to develop this as retail. Now, I recall that Ms. Horry also appeared before us before and said that the accommodation that the Planning Commission recommended of a retail zone with a, Stephen, if you can help me out, the non-conformity that may exist would be, they would have an exception to that, basically, a waiver of some type.
On use, yeah.
On use. So they does not restrict Arrowhead in any way, shape, or form from doing what they're doing in the conduct of their business. So with that, I think that this is still something that we ought to do because it's the voice of the people. It was the general plan, the intent of the general plan from the long process. And the other part that Ms. Horry talked about, the Planning Commission will get a plan of any kind of usage is not quite correct if I understand it, because if the use conforms to the zone, Stephen, is that if it conforms to the zoning requirements, then it doesn't have to go to the Planning Commission. It actually goes to your office and gets approved. Is that?
Not if construction is related, no. It is subject to site plan review for the Planning Commission for construction that would be related.
Even if it conforms with the existing use?
Correct. No matter what building is placed back there, if ever, it would be subject to site plan review.
Okay, thank you for that clarification. But with that, I think that this is still something that the community wanted, and if memory serves, Mayor Pro Tem, you yourself mentioned that you would like to see things built over there for the good of the community in the Carrier Row area. And with that, I'll turn it back to you. Thank you.
Josh?
I guess when I look at a project like this, the first thought is to how we got here and how much of the steps were very much reactionary. You know, we had not had a very long-term strategic plan, unless the general plan, and adhering to some of these items that are on there, and the compromises made to oppose moratorium, to oppose different items that really got us to the point where we take the specific uses. I'm torn in the sense because we need a viable economic engine for the city. If residents want retail, you know, that's the way to go. But also, when you have an industrial sector that's producing jobs where it's zoned for that currently, and if we have the ability to look, I guess for myself, I would defer to having a holistic view where we can go back, look at specific uses of the project, or sort of specific uses of the zoning, and to make a determination at the time to not change one specific area, but look at it as holistically for the whole. And in the terms of actual context or some of the items of truck depots, storage, that's, we know the community doesn't want those. If we have the ability to review those projects as they come forward, if they come forward, we know at the Planning Commission level, this council level, we can look at that and know the community input is not to where we want it. So if we have the review process and if we have the ability to look at it and say, develop a holistic approach for this area to make sure it's in line with where the community wants it to go, but also the trends of the businesses, I guess I'm more in favor of that approach.
Yeah, I probably more aligned with where Richard's at or Councilmember Murphy is, that I've been probably the most vocal that I thought that we were pretty reactionary starting at the moratorium, and then we just kind of kept on going and working into more issues. My perspective on Arrowhead, they're not going anywhere, and we got time to do it right. And I'm really interested, like Councilmember Kuzumoto said, of having the development that fits with the community over there. But because I feel that we have more time, I would really like to do the comprehensive zoning the correct way. And I think I'm just being consistent with what I've said. You know, we keep dealing with the pieces that spun out of this. This is, like Richard said, maybe the final prehistoric piece, but I hope we can get this thing back on track into a more methodical way. We did such a good job, you know, and I also feel for the Planning Commission. I just want to say the Planning Commission, I'm sure that we're driving them a little bit crazy. I know they work at our our pleasure. And, you know, and I've had confrontations in the years with them over certain things, but I feel for them being in the middle. It's like they're doing kind of what we're saying to do. We're kind of all over the place a little bit on this. And I think, you know, this is probably something that we could do a lot better. And you know, for the part of the community that was very vocal on this, I totally get it. But I do think in the end, you get a better project over there. And I think we'd also be able to work a little bit better with the property owner now. And then in the end, I think you got to go to the very, very end of this game. It's like, what happens 10, 15 years from now when they, if they ever do decide to leave? You know, we need a partner because, you know, we got problems in that corner. At that corner, we got problems with the three-way agreement with Cottonwood and the city of Cypress. And, you know, we don't need to I just think we got to think through a couple chess moves into this thing as how do we actually get a project there that's viable, get the people that are actually that own the property, get the right transaction, get the zoning set up. We got plenty of time to do that. But so that's where I'm at right now. Thank you.
Thank you. So 10 months later, we're still talking about this one piece of property and rezoning it. The Planning Commission brought to us an overlay that gave that development a choice. I'm just concerned that if we go ahead and rezone this now, next month, what property are we going to look at to rezone? And we're just going to piecemeal this all the way instead of just doing it right. We've done a couple things right to kind of stopgap any bad uses to it by getting rid of the couple of two uses. I really want to see, overall as a city, we need a zoning plan, just not in that area, but all throughout the city. So I'm in favor of leaving it as it is now, knowing that anything that happens back there has to go through an approval process through the commission, and then ultimately through us, and put it as a priority at the beginning of the 17-18 budget year. This is top priority to do this zoning review and do it right, so it's a long-term strategic thing. So with that, if there's a motion.
No, I'll go ahead and make a motion. I don't suppose I'll get a second, but maybe I can get a second and then we'll put it to a vote. But I'll move the staff recommendation of adopting the resolution.
Do we have a second? Do we have a substitute motion?
Just dies. Yeah.
Okay. We still need a motion.
To kill it, right?
I'll make a motion that we allow the zoning to stay as is and that we'll direct staff to further continue the comprehensive zoning plan. And that's my motion.
I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
No.
Okay. Are we to council comments now?
Mm-hmm. Who seconded it?
Shelley.
Okay. Council comments. Councilmember Wilson, let you start.
Great. I was able to attend the Chamber of Commerce swearing in, so I'm going to give congratulations to Emil George, Los Alamitos resident, on being the new chairman of the Chamber of Commerce. Also attended my first Orange County Library Advisory Council meeting, which was fun. They selected new officers on that. Wanted to just kind of call attention for a few items. One was in terms of the light of getting the, on January 30th, our Village 605 project, I've gotten a lot of emails, which is great. I want to encourage the public that if you have a voice in this, you get a flyer, please send me an email. Please share your thoughts, whether you're supporting, against it, specific items. I want to hear those comments. So as a new council member, it's exciting to me to receive that. And I try to respond to just say thank you very much for the comments. So I'm looking forward to having the community come out, voice their opinion on the project, and definitely encourage that. As part of that, what I would like to see at a future council meeting is that we really kind of bring our public disclosure area into the 21st century so that we stop, you know, at least limiting it at only having our disclosures public in a public place like the museum and then News Enterprise, but to also include at least maybe two social media posts as well. The same public disclosures that we give out in newspapers, we also include social media. So that way, as we look at other items to say, you know, why didn't I hear about this or I don't know, we actually communicate with the people where they are communicating. So if we know Nextdoor is a viable option, if it's Facebook, we can make it agnostic to which social media site that it is, so it allows us to freely choose, but at least two sites that we know people can use, and that way they can create a more notification and get out there in communication. So I'd at least like to see that at a future council meeting, and that could be as simple as a policy. Also, just because I saw next door, it looks like there's water quality issues in the Highlands, and the Golden State has been addressing it. Some things as well, too, where we can have a more notification system to know that if there are certain issues, our residents are not guessing at what's happening, but that we're being proactive on those same channels that members are, that are, sorry, our residents are communicating with, so that we can get this information out to them. And just a last item, I'm not sure the protocol on this one, but if we can close in the memory of J.M. Eibler for this meeting. I know he's been a longtime activist and supporter of our city, very fastidious in his research, and I think it would be, at least hopefully, we can honor him by closing his memory. Thank you.
Yeah, being the holidays was a pretty quiet period, but I did attend my first OCTA meeting. I want to thank my colleagues who helped me get elected to that board. Also, we started the Budget Standing Committee again, which I'm actually very proud of. I think we have a great budget process here. We spend a lot of time trying to get it right, but we don't rush. We put in the time, both on the committee and on the council. And I think by not rushing, we're making some good decisions. And I want to congratulate Daniel Patz, who also got, he was reappointed as chairman of the traffic committee. And, you know, when you're reappointed by your colleagues, it's very prestigious honor, I think. Wasn't meant to be self-serving. Thank you. I just realized it as I said it. Oh boy. Okay. And
yeah. Did you see the sign?
Yeah. I saw everybody's happy to see that too. I wanted to plug a business called IRI Parazione. They're a phone repair company with the worst location in the city. They're upstairs above 7-Eleven on Catella. They do great work. If you can find them, they're just a couple young guys in business. Hopefully their rent's cheap, because they're tough to find, even if you know where they are. And want to second Josh with JM. You know, he was a, you know, if you, whether you were agreeing with him or not, you could not fight the fact that he was well prepared, well thought out, cared as much as anybody about the city, and great loss for our city. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. So I attended the OC Mosquito and Vector Control meeting from last month, and there's one coming up this week. It really not much happened in December, just to sort of recap on the infection, the spread of it, and how we're dealing with it. So this year's going to be very interesting to see how we can make sure we're combating West Nile. And then on OC Parks, my other job that wasn't appointed by here, but I'm attending those, and I'm working with Corey and his staff and perhaps some other local staff to see if we can get an OC Parks concert out here. And I don't know how that's going, Corey, but maybe we can chat afterwards. But with that, back to you, Mayor. Thank you.
Mayor Pro Tem.
Yeah, I would want to echo what Councilmember Wilson talked about for the Village 605. You know, we think we're all getting a tremendous number of emails and interest on what's going on. And, you know, I would say two things. Keep the feedback coming, because we all go through. I know up here we read everything, and we try to keep an open mind until we go through. That is an issue that was heard by our planning commission, and you know, very seldom do we have things appealed to the city council. I can only think of one or two since I've been on. So it's something that we take really seriously, and we do it with an open mind. So a couple other things. Something to the rest of the city council is, you know, I'm not trying to plan by me being off the council, but I think in 2 years, the Rivers and Mountains Conservancy seat is going to be one that we should start talking about for what do we want to do to kind of maintain the potential, if we do want to maintain presence on that board. You know, I've been on there 6 or 7 years. I have an opportunity to appoint somebody to be my substitute. You know, there's county supervisors on there from LA County. They never come. And I was just wondering if somebody was interested and wanted to partner up. Dean Gross and I used to do this on some of the boards that we were on before. And then when you go to have to
go up against OCOG, and with the city selection process, you would be able to say, hey, look, I was actually helping cover that seat for a year or two, and might help us maintain it down the road. There's only a certain cities that are able to be on that because it's the San Gabriel corridor. So anybody that's interested, if you talk to me about it, I've asked the city manager to look at OCOG as the appointing agency for that board seat, and I'd have to get a letter from them, you know, appointing somebody, and I'd love it to be somebody in our council. I want to say congratulations again to Emil George. You know, we also serve, a couple of us serve with him on the Casa U shelter, and I just don't know how that guy does it. He's a great dad, I'll say first and foremost. Then he's in the community, and I feel for his wife. She's so nice, and I don't know when he's ever home to do stuff. But, you know, congratulations, Emil, and, you know, with the chamber, I think, you know, there's people in this room that have been chairman of the chamber, and I know that's a tremendous amount of time that's taken away, and Emil's got a really big, good business going, too, so I know it's going to be quite a sacrifice. Two plugs for nonprofits one more time. Again, March 4th, the Americana Awards, Kenny Brandyberry. Every time we're up here, I keep saying it, please. If you can, go to the Americana Awards online. You can sign up. You can contact the city manager. The seats are a little bit pricey, but again, it goes towards scholarships for kids that have a hard time affording it. But what's probably even more important this year is getting behind Kenny for all the things that he's done in the community. I just want to make sure everybody tries to go and support Kenny. And you know how appreciative he'll be. And if not, he'll torture you in May when he does Pizza Mondays again. The other part was at CASA. We have Finding Neverland. Everybody that has been to that, we're doing a show at Segerstrom Hall. It's basically a dinner fundraiser. It's a big event for the end of the year. And I would just say, too, the CASA Youth Shelter chief and myself and Josh are on that board, just trying to get as much people. We've got about 220 of 450 seats are sold so far for that, and the event's in 2 months. And I would just say, please go out there. This, again, is fighting to be able to help take the kids off the street, provide them a safe place, and get them back reunited with their family. Lastly, I think the ad hoc budget committee, you guys got a huge job ahead of you. And I'm glad it's you instead of me. But I just would say, please stay focused on the PERS issue as they do the reamortization of the timeline and the interest and the rate of return assumptions. You know, we took a $450,000 hit that we couldn't afford for the last 2 or 3 years. It was going to keep on going. For what it looks like, just if at the back of the envelope, this can go from $1.3 to $3 million a year. Our total budget's $12 million. So you guys got a lot of pre-work to do for us, but the rest of the council were here, and I know eventually we'll get the actuaries out here from PERS, but I honestly don't know how do you fill that hole with where our base is. And I think when you hear that, you start to look at projects like Village 605, and you see what we're trying to do over here at the beautification. But I mean, those don't even start, you know, making even a dent in it. So I would just say, you know, keep us informed of what your thoughts are, and we really appreciate it. So thank you. That's all I have.
Like December, I did attend the chamber breakfast, and I was able to recognize outgoing chair Ryan McLaughlin, who did a great job this year. Thank you for my under new management sign. And with that, there's a couple of things that I would like to add to the discussion item for the next meeting. First of all, and I don't think this involves council, but what I would like to do is on the agenda is to move our council comments to the beginning of the meeting, right after public comments. A lot of the stuff that we announce up here is important for the public to hear, upcoming events, things that are going to be affecting our city, and I think there's much more engagement at 6:20 than there is at almost 9 o'clock. But still keeping a quick additional comments at the end of meeting in case we need to add something based on what the outcome of the meeting was. So if that's okay with everybody, I'd like to start that for our next meeting in February. And then the two discussion items I'd like to add, one of them, and I've been wanting to do this for a while, is, you know, one of the constant complaints that we hear from residents is they just didn't know, despite our efforts of social media and posting it on our website and posting in the News Enterprise. You know, we do our due diligence, but we've got 16 neighborhoods, and a lot of times they don't know of things going on in our community. What I would like to propose is just to be able to discuss at our next meeting creating some sort of neighborhood commission, council. The names are irrelevant, the function is more important, and it's basically engaging at least a person from each of those neighborhoods to be able to have a communication outlet to them, maybe meet on a quarterly basis, whether it be formal or informal, but then also be able to get information out to them that they can post on their local next door, such as street lights are being redone, or there's a water issue, or, you know, with the technology, is everything's so instant that we can get information out so they can at least try and inform their neighborhoods much more quickly and efficiently than we can. So that's one of the things I would like to discuss. The other one, just kind of a little passion with me, and we can also discuss it, but I would like to explore, and I've talked to Corey a little bit about this, and also Brett, possibly taking an area in the very back of Little Cottonwood Park and making that an off-leash area. The people that have dogs in Apartment Row don't have an area to let their dogs roam a little bit free. They can, at Cottonwood, they can bring their dogs with the leash, but there's no place for them to let go a little bit free. We take our dogs over to Arbor Park, and they've taken a fenced-in area. So I would just like to discuss that and maybe throw it back to the Park and Rec Commission to maybe further explore some options, or if it's even feasible at all. So with that, City Manager?
I attended my first Orange County Waste Commission meeting, which Mayor Pro Tem congratulated me on already. And that was very interesting, actually very educational, learning a lot about recycling and working with our current franchise with Republic. So I enjoyed it. It was good. And then Race on the Basin, we can just give a quick update and promotion for our event that will be taking place next month. Corey?
Thank you very much, Mayor, members of the council. The Race on the Base, February 24th and 25th. You can see the banner in front of the mayor. Thank you for indulging us and letting us make a plug. Registration is about where we were at compared to last year. We're actually, I think, up four people compared to this time last year. So that's very exciting. Our triathlon, reverse triathlon, the numbers are up. So that's very exciting, down on a couple others, but I think all this rain is keeping people at bay and waiting till the last minute. At least that's what we're hoping for. Our shirts are ordered, our medals are ordered, and we're just plugging away at promotions. Just sent out an email last weekend to about 250,000 people, so we're really excited about that. Finalizing the details with the JFTB and working on the license agreement, but very excited. Friday night, the Glow Run, three waves, two different distances. Really, really excited. Our numbers are doing very, very well there. They're about two or three times where we were at this point last year. And we've got more giveaways and more glowing and whatnot. So we're very, very excited about that. So we definitely encourage the community. You heard our commissioner challenge the council tonight. So we do hope that you're all able to attend. We've also done that at one other commission. We will be attending the Planning Commission next week. Next week, the week after? Planning? Traffic? Yeah, planning coming up. And then we'll be sending an email out to the other commissions that don't meet regularly. So very excited, looking forward to having you all there, and looking forward to, want to thank all of our sponsors. We were actually up in sponsorship this year again, and very, very excited for the 20-plus sponsors that do help support this event. But without the registrations and without the community, we definitely couldn't have it. So thank you very much. Thank you.
All right, and something I thought I would never, ever have to do. I'd like to close in memory of J.M. Ivler. He's survived by his wife, Twee, 21-year-old daughter, Brooke, and 16-year-old son, Matthew, and his mother, Barbara. Even though a lot of us disagreed with his presentation, there was no doubt that he had a passion for his city. He wasn't afraid to speak out against things that he thought would hurt his precious LaSalle. Still waiting him for a walk down that aisle in his peach shirt, smell his cigar, and his motorcycle helmet in hand. So he's made an impact on our city, and prayers and blessings out to his family. Meeting adjourned.
Adjourned to back to closed session on the two items of litigation.
Okay. Thank you.
You can still come.